Boar's Head is bringing a slice of Japan to the deli. Introducing Boar's Head Ichiban Teriyaki Style Chicken. Tender, slow-roasted chicken breast, coated in our signature teriyaki glaze, where ginger, garlic, and a hint of brown sugar meet for a flavor that's both sweet and savory. New Boar's Head Ichiban Teriyaki Style Chicken. The bold flavor of Japan. Now at the deli. Only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
Blog Talk Radio.
This is True Capitalist Radio.
True Capitalist Radio.
I am your host, the man they call Ghost.
The badass of business.
Give him capitalism or give him death.
That's it. Period.
Broadcasting from his Skylight Office Studios in beautiful downtown Austin, Texas.
You sound fruitier than a box of Fruit Loops, for Christ's sake.
And now, he'll take it from here. Your host, the prognosticator of prognosticators, the man they call
Ghost.
Look who's back in the house for another Monday afternoon or going into the evening here in Austin, Texas, and I want to thank you very much for tuning in with me. You are listening to True Capitalist Radio. I am your host, the man they call Ghost, and once again, folks, I want to thank everybody for tuning in with me. It is episode number 53 for all the folks that are keeping track with the True Capitalist program. I hope everybody had a good weekend, with this crazy world, with all the things that are transpiring right before our very eyes. I strongly advise everybody to take advantage of every good free time, free weekend, free opportunity to do something that can at least stimulate some kind of decent mood in one's psyche, given the fact that we're always getting bad news and it seems to be getting worse and worse. Anyway, folks, as you can see on the description, folks, I don't want to make these long descriptions, you know. I mean, I know there's a lot of people out there that, you know, kind of criticize me about all the damn, all the damn description, you know. It looks like a damn novel out here, and I get it, all right? But there is a lot of subject matters to talk about. But anyway, folks, before we get on to anything else, I'd like for everybody to please retweet the broadcast right now if you're tuning in with us. Retweet the broadcast. blogtalkradio.com/ghost is the link to send people. And let everybody know that we're chatting here, we're kicking back, we're chilling. As a matter of fact, I've got myself a little bit of Macallan scotch here on ice. I want to say cheers to everybody out there. It's only Monday, I know. It's only Monday, but, you know, it gets better as the week goes on. Let me take a sip of this, and we'll move on to other subject matters. Good stuff. Anyway, folks, we had decent, modest gains in the markets today, folks, and it looks good. You know, it looks good. Oh, as a matter of fact, we closed out on the negative. Good God. You see, that just goes to show you how quick the market goes. You know, here I am. I schedule the show an hour before the market closes here. We're up above, from the last time I checked, was above 20-something points on the Dow. Everything was on the plus side. All of a sudden, I'm looking at it, we're on the negative. Good God! Anyway, well, I do look at other positions. I look at my own positions at that. There's a lot of situations. Anyway, we're on the negative. I'm going to go ahead and redo the description. I mean, we've been doing modest gains throughout the day. I mean, I knew it was going to be pretty flat in general. As I look at the losses that we took today, it didn't look that steep. I expected a flat day today on the market. We've been having a lot of increases since that dramatic loss 2 weeks ago. To be honest with you, folks, economic data looks good. More economic data continues to come down the pike that leads me to believe that, I mean, I don't know, is this United States stock market unstoppable? I'm serious, man. I mean, you've got earnings, you know, beating the street's expectations. You got economic data coming out. Like I said, last Friday, the reason we closed out on the upside throughout the whole entire week was because of earnings last week. What was it? Oracle on Friday morning posted a 78% increase on their profits. Oracle. I mean, they're even, you know, bitch slapping Hewlett-Packard around like they don't even need them anymore, for Christ's sake. I mean, that's just how I'm telling you, you know, they got their game on out there in Oracle. But we're continuing to see good earnings. We're continuing to see, opportunities out here. So, you know, when I see down days like this in a market like this, I kind of expected this kind of a down market. But I'm starting to believe. I mean, I hate to say this, I mean, but I'm starting to become one of the bulls here. I still would be a little apprehensive. Once again, folks, you want to get into stocks that are going to have profitability, who are going to have a demand for the product or service, and have good fundamentals. And if you have those three things encapsulating your stock, I would advise a buy on whatever it is. You know, you have to understand your sector that you're investing in. It's very tricky, but let me tell you, there's dramatic gains to be made. Anyway, let's just go ahead and go over the damn down market today. I mean, of course, it was flat. We still are way above 12,000. We closed out today at 12,197.90, a decrease of negative 22.71 points, a percentage decrease of 0.19%. S&P 500 closed out today at 1,310.19 points, an increase of 3.61%, decrease of 3.61 points. Excuse me, and a percentage decrease of 0.27%. These are all decreases, folks. I'm sorry. I'm too used to the damn decreases. I mean, it's been a good market, you know, to say the least. It's been a good market, whether you're a day trader or investor. NASDAQ also took some hits. It closed out today at 2,730.68, a decrease of 12.38 points, a percentage decrease of 0.45%. And let me tell you, commodities didn't do much good either. I mean, I don't know. I guess everybody's just selling off there at the end. Everybody just wanted to take their paper and, wait for the first of the month to start paying their bills or something. I have no idea. Either way, commodities took a pretty bad hit today. So, I mean, it was just, a pretty flat day on the market unless you rode the waves of earnings and the news, if you will. Brent crude is down. Brent crude's down 82 cents, closed out today at $114.77 a barrel of Brent crude oil. Gasoline futures are down $9.75, you know, and that's a good sign for our economy, folks. I'm glad we're starting to see decreases in gasoline oil futures. Heating oil futures are going down also. They were down today $3.23, a decrease of a little over a percent. Natural gas futures are modestly selling off. They're down 6 cents. And then WTI sweet crude. WTI sweet crude is continuing to go down. I know that we were talking about how they were $105 last week, hovering there, just kind of staying there, seeing what's happening. But as we're noticing from this so-called no-fly zone that the United Nations and America has implemented on Libya, the rebel strongholds are starting to take effect out there, and it's starting to look as if the rebels are going to take hold of this particular region of Libya. They've actually taken control of the oil ports, you know, the oil ports out there in Libya. They've actually taken control out there, and this is what's sending WTI sweet crude down. Now, why is this so important? I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I know, I'm sorry, folks, and I know people are laughing at me here. The reason is because I'm excited, because, like I said, I'm starting to believe that this may be a bull market for America. I mean, I can't believe it. I mean, we have to take in consideration, folks, that Japan, all right, Japan right now is, I think it's RIP for Japan, man. I mean, I don't know what else to say. I mean, that is the third largest economy in the world. It's just completely gone. I don't know what else to say, man. So that means that the third largest economy in the world is just completely, you know, eliminated practically. WTI sweet crude is going to have less demand. As a result, the energy is going to be a little bit less demand. Not to mention that, you know, it's going to have to make certain countries that were dependent on Japan's supply lines. Because Japan, believe it or not, folks, supplied a lot of companies in the automobile industry worldwide, parts, color pigments, and electronic gadgets. So if you're in the market for a car here in the next year and a half, folks, you're going to find that cars are going to be scarce. New cars are going to be scarce for the next 2 to 3 years in the world, not just in America, but in the world, because of the supply line just complete disruption, because of the devastation that's happened in Japan. So that's why you're seeing shutdowns all over the world in production lines in car production. Complete shutdowns because the parts that they usually get from Japan, which are, you know, the traditional car parts, color pigments, believe it or not, it's going to be hard to find a black or red car in the next 2 or 3 years. I kid you not. You think I'm joking? You read about it. I wrote about it on thecapitalistarmy.com in the forums out there. Oh, yeah, and by the way, if you're not a member of thecapitalistarmy.com, you're a moron. Go to capitalistarmy.com, become a member. But I talked about this in the forums out there. There's a link out there to a report by the Canadian Press, and there's a bunch of reports. I just chose the one by Canadian Press because I outlined it a little bit more in detail. They actually went out and asked people in Japan what this means to the automobile industry, and it's probably going to be one of the most lasting effects in the world automobile industry in the automobile's history. I mean, this supply line disruption is going to really affect automobiles. So as a result, we're seeing just WTI sweet crude go down because of all of these factors. The Libyan rebels taking control of Libya, you know, the possibility of a shortage in automobiles. I mean, it's just a whole bunch of stuff, a whole bunch of stuff. Anyway, it's good for us as regular everyday capitalists in America to see WTI sweet crude go down to 103. Once again, folks, I reiterate, and I'm going to keep reiterating this, if we can continue to see this WTI go down in price, we are going to see a rebound, a legitimate rebound. As a matter of fact, I forgot what person out of the Federal Reserve, it wasn't Bernanke, but one of these Federal Reserve governors kind of hinted towards a interest rate hike here in the near future. And the reason that they're just hinting towards that is because of the fact that I can even see it, any economist can see that the potential rebound out here is highly probable. You know, I'm not saying that it's guaranteed, nothing's guaranteed, but it's highly probable. And as WTI sweet crude continues to go down, that means that things can look good economically for people in America, folks. So let's keep our eye on WTI. Canola futures down $1.10. Cocoa futures are up $13. Like I said, folks, there's a million people exiting the Ivory Coast situation because Ivory Coast citizens are exiting the country because of this civil war that's happening, because this asshole president out there that got unelected democratically doesn't want to step down. Anyway, coffee futures are down after steep increases up until this point. They're down $4.65. Corn futures are down, thank God, $18.50, a dramatic increase there. It was down today on a percentage 2.68%. Cotton futures are also down. I'm glad to see that, down $7, a decrease of 3.42% on cotton just today alone. Wheat futures are also down $8. Sugar futures are down 81 cents. Soybean futures are down $9.75. $9.75 decrease on soybean oil. That's pretty steep. Lumber futures are taking a dive also after dramatic increases there. They're down $6.20. Soybean oil futures are down 31 cents, and wool has just flattened out, man. Didn't do anything today. Let me tell you, industrial metals took a hit, and the reason industrial metals took a hit because we were having, throughout the day up until the last hour of the stock market, we were having a modest rally. You know, I mean, there was some modest positive side volatility throughout the markets here. And as a result, when you see positive market output, you're going to see a reduction in commodities or a sell-off in commodities. And this is what we're seeing here in the industrial metals today. Copper took a hit today. It's down $7.15. Gold today took a little bit of a hit. It's down $6, closing out at $1,421.60, a decrease of 0.42%. But once again, folks, I mean, what was I talking about last week, Friday and Thursday? I was talking about silver, baby. I'm telling you, I think that there is a bull market on silver for some reason. I think it's because people are starting to believe that maybe the gold thing is a little bit overhyped. There's not that many industrial uses for gold. And I've said this time and time again, I mean, in the end, gold is a shiny rock, all right? It's something that makes, you know, chicks want to, you know, drop their panties, you know, when you got, you know, a nice $25,000 Rolex watch around your wrist. You know, or if you're one of these, you know, little flip, you know, Birdman guys, you know, with the million-dollar chain, you know, with a $2 million charm on it. You know, it's just a shiny rock. You know what I'm saying? Silver and copper, on the other hand, they have major industrial uses. Not to mention that, you know, you can also wear silver as a little charm. I mean, it's a little bit cheaper of a jewelry, but there's still people that wear it. I mean, look at James Avery, for heaven's sake. James Avery has made tons of cash. You know, I remember, you know, my son back in the 90s, you know, he used to have little girlfriends back in the day, and he would buy his little girlfriends little James Avery little rings with little charms on them. You know, and I'd give him money. You know, he wasn't working. He wasn't doing anything. He'd work for me. If he did anything, he'd work for me. You know, I'd have him do jobs. You know, I don't want to get into my personal life. Anyway, I'd give him money, you know. And to buy these little charms for these little chicks that he used to dig, you know, my son, back in like, geez, 93, 94, something of that nature, he would go and buy these little charms with the little rings, old James Avery rings, $20, you know, at the time, maybe $25 if it was a nice little intricate, detailed charm. You know those same rings right now? You know how much they're paying for them in James Avery, for Christ's sake? I mean, I went in there, you know, I was, you know, of course, walking around a shopping center, saw James Avery. I was like, oh, look, it's my son's little place. He should buy his chicks little rings there. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, we go in there. The damn rings are like over $150. I mean, it's just disgusting. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, I mean, not to get off on that tirade about James Avery, but part of that has to do with the silver, but also part of that has to do with the fact that James Avery has created its own market, and lo and behold, it can, you know, charge what it, you know, charged $20 for, you know, maybe 15, 20 years ago. Now they can charge $150 for it because they can do that. And now I'm sure with the silver prices going up, they're marking it up even more at this point. Anyway, silver, I'm bullish. I'm bullish on silver. There seems to be a bull market on silver. It's up today 8 cents amidst everything lost today. Everything seems to be on the downside today. But silver is up 8 cents. Closing out $37.13 a troy ounce. So let me tell you something, I'm bullish on that. Anyway, we're seeing sell-offs on livestock after dramatic increases. Live cattle futures are down 75 cents, which isn't much, really. I mean, I'd like to see that come down a little more. I'm sick and tired of paying, you know, a little bit heftier price for my damn artery-clogging triple cheeseburgers. Cattle feeder futures are down 27 cents. I'd like to see that price come down a little bit. And we've seen a little bit of decrease on lean hog, not much, but I'm still bullish on lean hog up until about for the next couple of weeks. And then after that, I'd start weighing out to see where that bottom's going to bottom out at, or where that is going to finally spike down to the bottom. Anyway, lean hog futures are down 65 cents, a percentage decrease of 0.63%. And that, my friend, is the markets for your ass. Anyway, I want to thank everybody for tuning in. I know we have a lot of things to talk about. One thing I want to lead in here after the market overview is Barack Obama's speech to the American people tonight. I believe it's at 7:30 Eastern time. Barack Obama, allegedly, or according to reports here, he is going to talk to the American people and basically tell them, hey, you need to get down with this Libya situation. And, you know, I found this interesting article out of Politico, even though I think it's, you know, just a bunch of political propaganda. But it's an interesting article. It's Barack Obama's message tonight on Libya. It's by Glenn Thrush. Thrush. Are you kidding me? That's a guy's name, Glenn Thrush? I mean, did you get laid with that name? I mean, anyway. Anyway, he talks. It's a good article, even though his name's kind of weird. It's a good article, and basically he's outlining what the president's message is going to be tonight. And for the most part, it goes something like this, all right? He's going to intro with it saying something to the effect that we're going to do this fast. I know that we're in Libya, and I know that we're doing, you know, all this no-fly zone, which is, you know, ended up coming to be nothing but a bunch of bombing, really. And I mean, it was... I've never heard of a no-fly zone bombing the hell out of, you know, people on the ground. But, hey, I don't know. Maybe that's a new theater of combat. But according to Obama and according to Politico here, they are going to make sure that the message is clear tonight, that it's going to be a short military theater of engagement, and that's the message that Barack Obama is going to first point out. Second point he's going to point out, and I guess this is a very crucial one for his credibility, in my view, is that somehow he's going to make the case that attacking Gaddafi is in our national interest. You know, I mean, he's going to make some kind of a case stating that, you know, we just had to go out there and get Gaddafi, baby. He was going to come into our hood. That's what he's going to do. He won't come into our hood. He was going to stop busting caps in our ass, so we had to go bust a cap in his ass. So, you know, that's how we had to do it, baby. He's going to make some kind of a case like that. He's going to make a case to justify that going after Muammar Gaddafi was a national security interest of America. So if you happen to be listening into a speech, be on the lookout for that explanation, because I would definitely like to know what explanation is that. You know what I'm saying? And, of course, folks, he is going to try to do some kind of, you know, emotional cadence speech-based yes, we can mantra to try to basically tell people, hey, get behind this, people. Get behind this military theater in Libya. I mean, that's what you need to do. If you are a good Obama supporter, you need to get behind this. You know? Seriously, I'm not joking. I mean, this is the outline of what is going to be put forth here to the American people via the president's speech today. What else is he going to talk about, folks? Well, I mean, come on, man. I mean, you know, let's talk a little bit about the other people that could use America's military force in helping them get the hell out of their political strife situation. Well, the president is going to say this, and this is according to Politico here, don't expect us to do the same thing in Syria, Yemen, Bahrain, Sudan, or Ivory Coast. And we've been talking about all those revolutions. If you've been an avid listener of this broadcast, you know what's going on over there. People are dying. People are getting, you know, mowed down like dogs out there. Iran's, I'm surprised that he just conveniently, or is going to conveniently forget Iran. He better not forget Iran. He better not forget Iran. Let me tell you something. Those are some true capitalist patriots out there in Iran. But look, this is it right here. He's going to say that don't expect us to do the same thing out here in Syria, Yemen, Bahrain, Sudan, Ivory Coast. Hopefully he throws in Iran in there, because that's a big one on my target list. And then last but not least, he's going to focus on the fact that, hey, man, I didn't back down, baby. I didn't back down, baby. I ain't no punk, baby. You know what I'm saying? You had all these people out here telling me, yeah, Barack Obama doing Nathan. He ain't doing Nathan, baby. He's sitting over there playing golf. He's sitting over there making brackets, baby, for NCAA titles, baby. You know what I'm saying? Hey, wait. I didn't back down, baby. I didn't back down, baby. That's what he's going to say. I kid you not. He's going to say, I didn't dither. I did not dither in the face of international unrest. And, you know, this is the crux of what's going to be talked about today, or tonight, I should say, by our president in his justification for using military assets of America in the implementation of some international United Nations NATO-based military offensive, because that's what it was. It's not a no-fly zone. It's a military offensive. It's a military offensive against Libya. I mean, give me a break. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, what's Obama got? I'm almost looking forward to it, you know, but then again, I'm not, because I'm probably going to miss some, you know, funny, you know, brain waste programming that's rather humorous. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't really want to see it. I know he's not in charge, folks. I mean, anybody who thinks Barack Obama is in charge is a moron. All right? I mean, he was locked out of the White House. I mean, can you believe this? I mean, folks, if you haven't checked out that footage, go to your nearest video portal site and look at Barack Obama after he gets off of the chopper. Get out of the chopper! He gets out of the chopper, and he goes to try to go into the White House, and it's locked. He's locked out of his own house. I mean, he had to go through a side entrance where the help comes out from and the Secret Service come out from and that sort of thing. He was locked out of his own house. Now, you see, these bureaucrats did that on purpose. I mean, I know people are saying, oh, I don't know why you're reading so much into that. Well, I think that is a blatant bureaucratic slap in the face showing that everybody on the inside that is basically conducting the policy, and all Barack Obama's doing is going out there in front of a teleprompter and just, you know, doing his, I am Barack Obama. And I mean, the same cadence-based speech, you know, everybody's kind of old, it's tired, it's no good no more, Barack. Come on, man. You got to get some jive in, baby. You know, you got to go a little George Jefferson on our ass or something there, Barack. Come on, baby. You know, you gotta get Fred Sanford, the spirit of Fred Sanford, go in there and say, yeah, baby, come on. You know what it's all about, baby. Hey, it wasn't my fault. It's not my fault, baby. I'm the president. It's all president about that. It ain't my fault, baby. I just wanted to be president, baby. That's all I wanted to do. That's why I'm here with the colony. I mean, seriously, that's basically what this presidency has come down to, man. I mean, I'm not trying to diss Obama because I don't like him or he's black or anything. I really don't care. But it's obvious, man, that everybody on the inside in the bureaucratic apparatus is just completely just dictating what the hell's being implemented as policy in America and in the international community. It's just disgusting. And this guy's just, you know, I hate to admit it, man, but he's just throwing race relations back like 50 years, man. 50 years with this, you know, lackadaisical attitude towards the presidency. I'm not joking, man. I'm sorry. I mean, look, I don't believe that this guy is in charge of anything. I'm not blaming him for anything. Believe it or not, I think that he's just, I think he was way over his head. You know, he just took an opportunity, and he's like, yeah, baby, these people like me, baby. Yeah, look at them. They're smiling for me, baby. They're smiling for me. And, you know, he just ran with it like, you know, like everybody does. Everybody just ran with it, ran for president, and believe it or not, he won. And now, I mean, he didn't know what the hell to do. I mean, I'm just really completely honest with you. I mean, and now you've got Hillary Clinton, Samantha Power, Susan Rice. All these broads, you know, it's like the feminazi takeover of the bureaucratic apparatus of American government, and these chicken hawk broads are the ones that blew it in this guy's ear that, hey, you know, we got to go into Libya and bomb the hell out of Gaddafi. You know, I mean, look at Obama. He doesn't know why we're going in there. Why do you think we have such mixed messages, for Christ's sake? You know, you got, the president saying he wants Gaddafi gone, as if he's the one going to go in there and, you know, snag him out of the country himself. You've got Robert Gates saying, well, that's not the objective of the military. You know, the military objective is just to, you know, cover a no-fly zone and to help the rebels achieve certain military goals against them. And then you got Hillary Clinton saying something completely different. I mean, it's just, it's disgraceful, man. It's an utter disgrace, you know, and it's dangerous. It really is. It's getting dangerous for America, for Christ's sake. And, you know, I don't know what Barack Obama's going to say in this little, speech to America about Libya. I know that he's going to try to justify it. I don't understand how Gaddafi was in somehow a vital portion of our national interest or national security or anything of that nature. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's just, I don't get it, man. I don't get it. I mean, you campaigned on being the peace president. Remember that? I mean, this wasn't that long ago, man. I mean, I remember these idiots. They called into my show at that time, man. I was broadcasting in 2008. Yeah, I was broadcasting back then, man. They were saying, oh, he's going to bring in peace. He's going to bring in everything. He's going to bring in change, man. He's going to bring in change. Man, he's left all the Poe people and all the people, he's left them with change in their pocket. You know what I mean? Let me take a sip of my Macallan scotch here, for Christ's sake. I mean, I can't believe this. I mean, you might as well turn drunk. You know, if you're an alcoholic, start sipping the alcohol, because the world is going to hell. I mean, and nobody in power seems to give two rat's asses. Everybody's just, you know, I think they're just out for more and more power. You know, the bureaucrats are out for more and more power. The international institutions like the United Nations and NATO are out for more power. It's getting disgraceful, man. It's getting disgusting out here. This is why us as capitalists, we need to stick together, you know, worldwide on a global scale. And we need to differentiate ourselves from every other masses out here that are just out here with their hand out. Because us as capitalists, that's not what we are. If you're a capitalist, that means that you're working for a living. You're paying taxes. That means you're paying for your government. If you're working and paying taxes, that means you are paying for your government, and yet your government seems to be taking out their, you know, pecker shaft and giving you a slap on the face with it every single time that they overregulate private enterprise, every time that they raise taxes, you know? I mean, it's disgusting, man. Let me take a sip of this. Good stuff, man. Anyway, you want to be a part of a capitalist army. You want to be a part of a global-wide social network dedicated to capitalists. Capitalistarmy.com. Join that right there. Capitalistarmy.com. Bringing together capitalists worldwide. Not to mention that you can, you know, create your own store to sell your own crap. Integrate check to go and PayPal, and I mean, I'm serious, folks. I mean, you know, I'm trying to give opportunities out here for capitalists so that we can get together and organize ourselves to differentiate, to make ourselves separate from the masses out here that are doing nothing but turning perfectly good food into crap and thinking that they need more of it or something. I don't know. Anyway, about the president, I mean, I know I'm going off keister here, folks, but it's upsetting, man. It's upsetting that, you know, the president is just completely out of whack. The people in the bureaucratic circles of government, they're the ones in control. They're the ones basically waving their finger at Obama. They're the ones putting the teleprompters in his face. They're the ones puppeteering this guy. It's unbelievable. Anybody who blames Barack Obama for their problems, you know, don't blame him. He's just, you voted for him. You know, you voted for this guy. I mean, you know, you're the guys that went out and said, yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we. Remember that? What happened to that mantra? You know, whatever happened to the change mantra? You know what I'm saying? Whatever happened to these things? Now you've got this man who signed in stimulus package 2, signed in all these bailouts for all the multinational corporations that needed the money. You got, you know, I mean, do you understand what I'm saying? What happened? The Poe in America just got, like, the peanuts. They got the beans, you know. They got a 20% increase on their food card, and, you know, they got, like, a couple of extra dollars on their housing voucher programs. You know, they got some money to rebuild the projects or some kind of garbage like that. Big deal. I mean, look at Goldman Sachs. Look at GE. And let me tell you, GM, I mean, I'm invested in these companies, folks. Why do you think I'm advising folks to go out there and, you know, consider or entertain in GE or GM long term? Because we refinanced their whole debt. Do you understand that? I mean, it's easy to be profitable when you've got the American taxpayers just completely bankrolling all of your debt and recapitalizing your whole entire multinational operation. Everybody's all pissing and moaning, oh, GE didn't pay any taxes last year. They paid no taxes last year. Hey, yes, we can. You know? Yes, we can, huh? There you go. You know, people are bitching and moaning. Oh, look, hey, Goldman Sachs did the derivatives. Now they're in control of the treasury. Yes, we can. Huh? Oh, GM got recapitalized. Hey, this is your president, man. You understand? This is why, and I will continue to make this case, that not everybody in America deserves the right to vote. Do you understand this? The general masses do not deserve the right to vote. You know who deserves the right to vote? Capitalists. Capitalists exclusively. And why? Because we're the ones that are bankrolling these governments. I mean, it makes no sense to me. No sense whatsoever. Why individuals who are mooching off of the American government have any kind of an authority on the political system, given the fact that if they're getting paid by our government, they have a economic interest. They have an actual payoff at the end of voting for a specific candidate. It's bribery, for heaven's sake. It's what it is. It's bribery. I don't see why everybody should have the right to vote. I think that if you go to the voting booth and you want to vote and you want to participate in the political process, there should be a prerequisite that you show a W-2 form or whatever, however you file your taxes. You show that form to the person running that voting booth center there to prove, first of all, I mean, you know, I know people are pissing and moaning about, you know, illegal immigrants voting, not voting. Hey, that showing a tax form that you paid taxes eliminates all that crap. It eliminates all of it. So, I mean, even if they are an immigrant, who cares? They're paying taxes, for Christ's sake. I mean, shouldn't the people that pay for the government have the authority over those that don't? You know? I mean, give me a break, man. I know that people are sitting here saying, oh, that's not right, Ghost. I mean, what about the Poe? Well, you know, I don't believe that there's poor in America, man. I'm sorry. I know people that are sitting here, they're pissing and moaning that, oh, man, how can he say there's not poor in America? Well, you want to know what poor is in America? Poor in America is being, you know, put in a certain subjugated part of a metropolis or a bad part of town in some small town, collecting government entitlements and getting fat in the ass, and living in some kind of project or Section 8-based subdivision. And to me, that doesn't seem very Poe when you ain't got to do a goddamn thing to get it. I don't see where that's Poe in America. When you don't have to do anything to get something, I don't see where that's Poe in America. You understand what I'm saying? You go to any area in this country that's Poe, all right, that's so-called Poe, I guarantee you see iPods in their hand and iPhones in their hand. I guarantee you see plasma screen TVs in their shacks. I guarantee you see electronic widgets all over the place. I guarantee you that you see this. Not to mention that you go to any white trailer park, black ghetto or Mexican barrio, You are going to see fat, jelly-ass people waddling their fat asses up and down the street. And I kid you not. You think I'm joking. You go out and look for yourself. Look for yourself. And how in the hell can you be po when you're getting fat? I never understood that. I mean, you know, isn't that a disgrace to all the people that are starving in Africa? The people that are starving in, like, you know, these third world countries? Isn't that a slap in the mouth to sit here and have fat asses, supposedly in impoverished parts of the country, sit here pissing and moaning about how they're po in America, and yet they're fat in the ass? That's just a slap in the face to people that are out here malnourished, dying of starvation in skin and bones. I think it's just a disgrace. So that's why, you know, I think exclusively the party that should be voting in elections in America and in every country throughout the international community should be the capitalist. And how are you a capitalist? What makes you a capitalist? Well, all you got to do is show a tax form showing that you, you know, paid taxes. And that's the bottom line, and an ID or something to make sure that, you know, everybody knows who you are. Like, you're not just some schmuck, you know, coming in from some other country trying to, you know, alter the election or trying to commit fraud or anything of that nature. I mean, it's that simple. I mean, you know, how hard is this? You know? And even, you know, even if you don't have any, I mean, do you understand me? God damn it, man. It just pisses me off. It's really that simple, man. Let me take a sip of this before I get a heart attack here. Very good. Wait a minute. So, is somebody sitting here trying to say that, are you trying to justify Brody, the poet America, milking the American taxpayer as capitalist, negotiating the better deal for themselves? Is that your argument in this chat room? I'm sorry, folks. I don't mean to get off keister here. I'm looking at the chat room, and there's some person here attempting to make some kind of an argument for the poet America. As he's trying to compare the Poe extorting taxpayers with that of capitalists trying to get the best deal in a business deal. I mean, are you serious? Or are you just joking? Or are you just trying to piss me off? Huh? You're not joking? Well, why don't you get off your fat cottage cheese ass, and I want you to give me a call right now, 646-652-4869. I'd like for you to get on the damn horn right now and justify what in the hell you're flapping on the keyboard right here, right now. All right? I want you to justify it right now. All right? And I will give you time. I'm not going to sit here and, you know, I want you to justify it with substance. Don't sit here and try to compare the Poe in America extorting money out of the taxpaying dollar, out of the taxpaying system, to capitalists trying to get a decent business deal on the negotiating table. There is no comparison, and for you to sit over here and make that comparison, it besmirches the integrity of capitalists themselves. You're lucky we're in cyberland, bub. You understand? You're lucky this ain't some damn bar room, because let me tell you something, I think it's a disgrace. Alright? No, and it's making me mad. Because, first of all, the Poe in America have every opportunity, like everyone else, to obtain their own way of living, their own way of sustenance. Everybody who thinks that they don't is an idiot, all right? I mean, you can do anything you want. Let's say you were thrown out in the street with the clothes on your back. That's it, all right? Let me explain something right now. If you were thrown out in the street with the clothes on your back, out here in America, you know, you what you can do? You can go out, buy a dozen roses at some, you know, supermarket for about, you know, $7.99, sell them on the side of the road for about $3 or $4 a piece, $5 a piece or some crap. Oh, well, how do you get the money today? Well, the same way all these bums on the street, you know, with the "we'll work for food" signs get, you know, $200-$300 a day from you idiots that keep giving them money. Yeah. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying? I mean, you know, you keep giving these idiots money out in the streets. We'll work for food. What are they doing with it? They're going back out there to get it because it's easy. It's disgraceful. And somebody here is saying, oh, why can't people ask for a discount at your store, Ghost? Because I'm a retail location, Peter. All right, on a retail location. You're going to go into a retail location and haggle, for Christ's sake? Why don't you save that crap for the swap meet or the Goodwill, all right? Save that crap for the Salvation Army or some crap. You don't go into a damn retail location where you're selling retail products and say, yeah, you know, baby, I know this here say $10, baby, but I got $4 here, baby. I got $4. I'm going to give you $4. And I know this costs $10, but I'm going to give you $4, and I'm just going to take this here, baby. Is that all right? And I'm just going to say no, because it's a $10 retail item. You need to pay the $10. What's the negotiating tactic? I mean, my kids, baby. You're not understanding, baby. You're not having no compassion, baby. My kids, baby. And I don't see how that's, no, absolutely, and I don't sit here and justify losers coming into my retail location attempting to haggle me off of a retail price as that of a capitalist negotiating at a negotiating table for an actual business transaction that's relevant. Don't sit here and make that comparison. Give me a damn break. Anyway, let me get back to the show here. President Barack Obama is going to speak tonight, folks. He's going to justify what's going on out there in Libya. He's going to sit here and say, I had to do it, baby. I had to do it. It's in the national security interest of America, baby. You know, he's gonna sit there and all this other crap. So it's all there is to it. No, bargaining is okay. No. See, people are saying, is bargaining okay? No, bargaining is okay, but you can't go into a retail outlet. You can't go into a damn Walmart and, you know, go up to the counter and you've got something for $50 and say, look, to the cashier that's probably getting paid minimum wage. You can't go up to him and say, yeah, baby, look, I noticed it said $50. I'm going to give you $25, and that's all there is to it, baby. You understand what I'm saying? You can't do that. But if you're, you know, in a informal setting, you're selling a business, or you're selling a, you're out there in an informal setting, you're selling some kind of a product that can be negotiated. No question you should be able to bargain, you know? Of course you should be able to bargain, but, you know, to sit here and go into a retail location, you know how you bargain with a retail outlet or a retail multinational conglomerate? I'll tell you how. Just don't go buy it. How about that? How about you and everybody in your community just don't go to that store when they put the high prices, and then by default, you can, it'll just, they'll have to put the prices down. They got to get rid of product, you know? So that's the difference between, I just don't think it's appropriate for you to go into a retail location and bargain. Those are retail prices set forth to the general public. You know, I mean, it's just that you can't make any kind of, negotiating tactic unless the retail outlet initiates some percentage off or some kind of crap. But anyway, if you go to a pawn store, you're exactly right, Goofy. I mean, you go to a pawn shop, you can negotiate your ass off. That's why I love pawn shops, man. I mean, let me tell you, these idiots out here in America, they buy crap, they buy it brand new. 2 months goes by, they got rent to pay, they got, a car payment, they got all this other garbage. Lo and behold, they gotta pawn these things, you know, pennies on the dollar, and here you are, you can just kind of snag that crap up with a whole bunch of other stuff, man. I mean, absolutely. Absolutely. Anyway, let's wait for Obama. Let's see what he has to say tonight. I'm not looking forward to it. I know that somebody else wrote it. This is the brainchild of the bureaucratic apparatus in the American government. Barack Obama is not in charge of the government. No president in American history has ever gotten locked out of the White House. Ever. And there's footage of that, if you don't believe me. He was locked out of the White House, and it was just... It was horrible, man! Oh, Jesus Christ. Hey, Brody, I wouldn't invest all in precious metals there, Brody. I mean, you want to diversify your portfolio. I mean, don't put all your eggs in one basket. I am bullish on industrial metals, don't get me wrong, or precious metals. But I would be apprehensive to put all my money into anything. You just need to diversify. You know what I'm saying? You know, just diversify. Anyway, let's continue going, folks. Anyway, let's wait for Barack Obama, see if he turns this into more Junkyard America. Anyway, In more serious news, folks, Japan, like I was stating Friday, what did I say Friday and Saturday? Or not Friday, Thursday and Friday. What was I saying? I was saying that if a certain nuclear rod is exposed, that plutonium is going to get into the atmosphere, which is a hell of a lot worse than uranium smoke or radioactivity or any of that stuff. Now we're getting serious, folks. It's getting serious as a heart attack when it comes to this Japan situation. It's starting to affect America on a serious basis here, man. I mean, I know that at the time when this nuclear reactor first started melting down, people in the chat room were like, you're making a lot of it, Ghost. Ghost, come on, it's not going to get that serious. Don't worry about it. Hey, Ghost, it's not going to do nothing. Don't worry, Ghost. Let me tell you something right now. Plutonium has now been found in the soil at the nuclear power plant in Fukushima. And let me tell you, this is not getting pretty, folks. The people in Japan, you should do a YouTube search about, Japan citizens making YouTube videos. There's people crying. They don't know what to do. It's really unbelievable. You know, it's really, really unbelievable what's happening out here. I saw one guy, some Australian out of Japan, he was crying on, the camera saying, he doesn't want to leave Japan, but he's going to have to. It was raining out there in Tokyo, and he said some of the rain got on him, and now he's got red spots on where, some of the rain droplets got on his face. And he was saying, oh, man, I know this looks like, zits and it looks like acne, but I have never had acne my whole life. All of a sudden it rains and, the raindrops get on my face and I got red spots all over my face. Let me tell you something, folks. I've told you, once this radioactive plutonium, this stuff goes into the air, it's going to be in there and it's going to be in our rain. We've already found traces of it in rain in Massachusetts. We've already found it in Massachusetts, folks. It's all over the goddamn country now, all right? That's what it is. It's all over the country. You can look for yourself. You can look. I believe there is a website. There is a website that is dedicated to basically keeping the public out. I forgot the name of it. I'm sorry. I should have looked that up before the broadcast, but you can probably find it yourself, all right? It's basically showing the radioactive levels all across the country, folks, and it's really unbelievable. I just can't believe that nobody has been taking this as serious as I have. And for all the folks that have been listening in, you know as well as I've been talking about this ever since this whole debacle with this nuclear reactor started becoming news. I mean, everybody was talking that I was hyper-sensationalizing all the radiation in the air. There's nothing happening. There's nothing wrong. It's minor levels. Folks, it's starting to not only affect our country, and it's not only radioactivity and radioactive material being put in our rain. Now we've got this plutonium leaking into the fucking Pacific Ocean, man. I'm sorry for cursing, but the Pacific Ocean is being infected with this ridiculous, disgusting plutonium nuclear runoff, for Christ's sake. Yeah, so, if you happen to be somebody who likes seafood, you better make sure that it's not in the Pacific, and, you better eat it as long as you can, even if it's in the Atlantic or in the Gulf. Just eat it as much as you can, because let me tell you, it's going to come to them too, man. Radioactivity is going to come. I mean, I just think it's a disgrace, man. I have been calling ever since we started hearing about smoke coming from these reactors. I was calling for cement and wet mud just to be put on this entire nuclear reactor area. We should have done what we did in Chernobyl. These people, the country, the government of Japan, and the company that owns these reactors should be held accountable right now. The international community, if they want to intervene in anything, instead of going after a Michael Jackson look-alike Arab in the middle of the desert, they should be intervening with these goddamn Japanese that are out there just pussyfooting around with this nuclear situation. And look, I know there's people sitting here saying, oh, I mean, how can you say that? Look, the Japanese government and the Japanese companies are basically killing their own people. They're killing their own people, and at the same time, they are affecting us in America. There's been high levels of radiation in China. In China, there's been radiation in Russia, so it's affecting Europe. It's affecting America. It's affecting the whole entire international community. And for the international community to just sit on its thumb and not do something about this is just ridiculous. It nullifies the whole reason why we should have the United Nations. It nullifies the whole reason why we should have NATO. These bureaucratic international institutions are good for nothing. They're good for nothing. And you can tell them I said that. I mean, you can never trust a bureaucrat, man, ever, ever. And in my personal opinion, if they wanted to have any kind of credibility in this world, if the United Nations or NATO or anybody wanted any kind of credibility, they would unilaterally just dump cement and mud, all encapsulating all that nuclear garbage, burying it, so that if it does melt down, it's melt down in that pile of cement and mud. This is what they did in Chernobyl. This is what they had to do, for Christ's sake. This is what they had to do, and I've been calling for this ever since we started seeing smoke out of those reactors, man. This is not a joke. I'm not joking, man. You can look this up for yourself. I know that the American media on the boob tube is not telling anybody any of this stuff, but you need to do your research, you know? I mean, seriously, you should really seriously consider, especially those on the West Coast, those in Hawaii especially. You know, I know I got a couple of prank callers in Hawaii, but, you know, even though you're a bunch of Milky Lickers that prank call me, hey, I'm concerned about you out there, man. You better take cover. I mean, I don't know what to say, man. I mean, this is scary crap. I mean, this is really scary crap. Let me take a sip of this damn scotch, for Christ's sake. Jesus. Telling you, man. Unbelievable. No, I'm not saying you were laughing. I'm just saying in general, this is a scary situation, man. This is just an unbelievable situation. And I'm going to continue to keep people informed about what the hell's going on out here. All right, I mean, seriously, I mean, we really have to keep each other informed. We have to start calling our congressmen, calling our senators and saying, hey, if you idiots don't get on the ball, first of all, we've got a budget crisis going on once again. The government may shut down this Friday once again, but we're going to talk about that later. They need to start, you know, pushing the president to, you know, get the United Nations to act on Japan. I mean, they're killing – you're talking about Libya killing their own people. The Japanese government and this company that owns this reactor are killing their own people. They are killing their own people. Why isn't the United Nations going in there and just unilaterally acting on the behalf of the incompetent Japanese government? Can somebody please answer this question for me? I mean, we're sitting over here bombing the hell out of Libya. All right? We're bombing the hell out of Libya for a supposed humanitarian effort. We've got a genuine humanitarian effort here in Japan. Japan, the Japanese government is pussyfooting around. The company's pussyfooting around. Why exactly we aren't, you know, why we didn't do this in the beginning to go in there and just put mud and cement all over the damn reactors is beyond me. But why, the United Nations is nullifying their reason for existence, in my opinion. The United Nations, NATO, I mean, these are just bureaucratic bunch of idiots, man. They don't care about the people. They don't care about the stability of the international community. If they cared, they would do something about this. All right, they would do something about this. But no, we got to go into Libya. Stupid United Nations. I'm telling you, folks, this is why bureaucrats, you know, us as capitalists, we have to make it our mission to limit and to reduce the power of bureaucrats on a global scale. Because these bureaucrats are incompetent. All right? I mean, it's incompetent, for Christ's sake. Anyway, 646-652-4869. I want to hear from you. What do you think of this crap? Huh? Do you think I'm being hard on the Japanese government because they're just sitting there pussyfooting around with these nuclear reactors when they should be, you know, putting some goddamn wet cement and wet mud on the goddamn crap and encapsulating this nuclear dump? I mean, come on. Our government, of course, is trying to tell us, oh, nothing's wrong, nothing's wrong. Just go ahead and go out, keep shopping. It's all right, don't worry about it. Everything will be all right. I think this is a disgrace. Anyway, we're in the second hour of the True Capitalist Radio broadcast. I am your host, the man they call Ghost. And once again, folks, I want to thank everybody for tuning in with me. If you could please retweet the broadcast at blogtalkradio.com/ghost. Tell everybody to come on down. We're chatting. We're chilling. I want to give some shout-outs to the people that are in here. Baba Ganoush, what's going on, man? Brawny, what's going on? Capitalizing in the house. Dr. Han Solo in the house. What's going on, future DMB? Goofy Bone, just give her a bone. You know what I'm saying? All the guests that are in the place. There's a lot of you. What's going on? Michael Thomas in the house. Mystery Man in the house, Gotta Eats in the house, Peter Bergeron, Rob Dar is in the house, the tech guy is here, what's going on, the truth is out there, what's going on, man, USA Patriot 1776 is in the house, and of course Vince in the Bay, man, what's going on, Vince. Anyway, I want to thank everybody for tuning in with me. Please retweet the broadcast, blogtalkradio.com/ghost. Anyway, let's continue on, shall we? Oh, yeah, where's Goku? Oh, yeah, man, my bad. What's up, Goku? Completely skipped over Goku, for Christ's sake. Everybody's got their caps on, and Goku's sitting there with his lowercase letters, man. I'm telling you. That's what happens in text, man. I'm telling you, man. You start looking at the you forget the fine print, baby. That's what you got to worry. That's why you pay your lawyers, man. That's why you got to pay your goddamn lawyers to that crap. Anyway, 646-652-4869. Is anybody concerned about the Japanese nuclear plutonium that's being put into the atmosphere? It's affecting people globally. Chinese are, you know, detecting high levels of radiation. The Russians were detecting radiations on the West Coast in Denver. We're detecting low amounts of radiation in the rain in Massachusetts. Let me tell you something, man. Unbelievable, you know. I just don't know what the hell. I don't know what to say, man. I don't know what to say. I mean, all I got to say is, if you were an alcoholic, you might as well keep drinking. If you're depressed, you might as well, you know, start smoking reefer or, you know, drinking or doing something. Because look, there's no time to cry. There's no time to worry. It's just time to capitalize and live large. You know what I'm saying? I mean, things happen. You know. Things happen, and unfortunately, we just have to continue going. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm going to keep capitalizing, I'm going to keep living large, I'm going to keep living lavish, and I hope you do too, folks. And this goes out to all the capitalists out there. This is why we all have to make sure our interest, and who's our interest? I'm talking about the capitalist interest. We have to make sure that our interest is at the forefront of not only this country, but every country throughout the international community, because capitalism inspires the greatest of mankind. It's what brought in the technological revolution. It's what brought in the industrial revolution. It's what brought in the greatest innovation in sciences and medicines. It's what's prolonged human life. It's what's given us an ease of lifestyle. It's what's given us all the perks that we are using and abusing. It's either give me capitalism or give me death. And if you believe the same thing, well then, by God, why don't you join the capitalist army? Join the capitalist army at capitalistarmy.com. All right? It's easy. It's a social networking site dedicated to the true capitalists out there so that we can exchange ideas, so that we can exchange social networks, so that we can spread the message of capitalism throughout the world and act in concert if necessary. CapitalistArmy.com. And spread the word about it, and make sure that you're a capitalist too, because if you're not a capitalist, we don't want you, and you ain't going to be able to join. All right? If you're some mooching-ass, milky-licking piece of government-entitled recipient garbage, We don't want you. You know what I'm saying? We don't want you. We want capitalists. CapitalistArmy.com. And let me tell you something, folks. We got profiles. We got videos. We got audio. We got chat rooms, video chat rooms. We got forums. We got an area where you can put your own store on your profile, you know? Give me a break. And people are saying the banners are a little tacky. Well, you know, it's either that or I charge admission. You know what I'm saying? Sorry. All right, we're still working on the whole aesthetics of the whole thing. I mean, it was bad enough getting the code right on all this garbage. I mean, let's just go ahead and, ease in the graphical aesthetics as gradually as possible. Yeah, and let me tell you, all the people that are accepted in here, hey, much props. We're going to try to spread ideas on how to get people into the capitalist game, get people doing right with their money. I'm not joking, man. This is all about capital, man. It's all about money. CapitalistArmy.com, all about cash. That's what it's all about, man. Anyway, let's move on to another subject matter. We had an explosion earlier today in Yemen. For you folks that aren't familiar with what's going on in Yemen, we're having a civil unrest to the point where it's getting damn near dangerous. Now we had an explosion out there that has killed 78 people amidst this anti-government unrest, and this is just kind of throwing fuel on the fire on this destabilization that's happening in Yemen. The leader out there is on the verge of collapse. It's getting pretty scary. And remember, Yemen has a high contingent of Al-Qaeda. A high contingent. I mean, as a matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken, wasn't Osama bin Laden born in Yemen? But this has got a high, contingency of Al-Qaeda fighters. And if Yemen goes down, folks, I think that everybody should be concerned. You're talking about national security interest of America. Everybody should take a look at what happens and what transpires when the Yemeni's government finally collapses from all this unrest. And let me tell you, it's getting chaotic, to say the least, out there in Yemen. I mean, they just had 78 people dead today, man. One bomb, 78 people dead. You know? Straight up, 78 people dead. No big deal. Oh, it's okay. Let me tell you, it's getting hairy out here, man. It's getting scary. It's getting hairy. It's getting freaked out, for Christ's sake. And there doesn't need to be all this disorder, man. You know, it really makes me sick to my stomach how, and I hate to say this, but, stupid, people are in this country, and not only this country, but in the world, where they feel that they have to go into some chaotic mass hysteria so that they can somehow get things implemented, in their country. And what's really sad is that they don't really know what the hell they want. I mean, as we saw with Egypt, and let me tell you, I was one of the highly voiced critics out here against the Egyptian Revolution. I thought the Egyptian Revolution was a joke. And as we're seeing what's transpiring in Egypt thus far, it just proves my assumption that it was a joke. You know, I mean, these people don't know what they want. They don't know whether they want an Islamic state. They don't know whether they want capitalism. They don't know whether they want democracy. They don't know what they want. They don't know whether they want communism. They don't know whether they want socialism. It's a disgrace, man. It's just an utter disgrace. And then the places that have proven their loyalty to capitalism and democracy. I'm talking about the revolutionaries in Iran. The Iranian revolutionaries that have been getting mowed down and tortured, their families have been snagged and tortured and imprisoned since 2009. Now I'm talking about the uprising in Iran. And I will never forget those patriots in Iran. Let me tell you something. I was directly corresponding with them in 2009, directly corresponding with them until the government took control of the internet and is basically regulating the internet up to this point. I mean, in my personal opinion, that's a humanitarian national interest story for America. But are you hearing anything about it? No. Instead, we're allowing Iran to saber-rattle throughout the international community which is exactly what they want. They're trying to bait anybody who will listen into some kind of a damn international military theater with Iran so that all the civil unrest that they're having in their country will be quashed under the guise of war. Because what's the best social organization method to bring a people together, folks? War. That's right, war. That's why, you know, believe it or not, I think the liberal regime is a little taken back that, you know, the American people aren't really going aboard with this Libyan offensive. You know, they're really taken back. They're used to seeing, you know, anytime America gets into kind of military conflict, the old rally around the flag effect. And I think that's what the, you know, women feminist chicken hawks that orchestrated this Libyan offensive, Hillary Clinton, Susan Rice, and Samantha Powers, I think that's probably what they anticipated. You know, they anticipated the old rally around the flag situation, you know. And it didn't happen. And this is another reason why Barack Obama today is going to go out and try to, you know, tap dance, you know, around all this garbage that we're doing out here in the international community. But meanwhile, we got Yemen out here, you know, going under complete civil unrest, and that could spread around. I mean, the chaos that's happening in Yemen, I mean, an explosion. I was waiting for something like this, believe me. Now it's happening. Yemen explosion kills 78 people. I mean, there's more deaths coming out as we are speaking here. I've just... I don't really have time to check into it, but at the time that we posted this story, the Yemenis people take an explosion during anti-government protests, 78 people dead. Man, and we're going to expect to see a lot more of this. Let me tell you this right now. Not only that, let's move to Syria now, huh? Syria now is trying to strive for order. They killed another 15 people today. They've been killing people every single day by just mowing these people down in an attempt at quashing the civil unrest in Syria. But it just doesn't seem to work. I mean, these people don't care. I mean, they are sick of Assad and the Ba'athist Party out there. I mean, we have to remember that Assad is there because his father bequeathed him the country of Syria. And to be completely honest with you, Assad, you know, outside of, you know, being loosely... open to the idea of international investment. It just hasn't been enough freedom at a sooner enough time for the people. And now the people are rising up out there. And let me tell you, the government is they're trying to quash the civil unrest in Syria by killing these people. But it doesn't seem to work. So now Assad is considering loosening the authoritarian rule that his country has over his people. He's actually considering freedoms out here. He's like, hey, come on, no, you don't want me out. You'll never get freedom. I guarantee freedom here. Come on. You'll love this country. Seriously, that's what he's that scared. Let's put it that way. And let me tell you, I mean, all these people in the Middle East should be scared. You know, as a matter of fact, I'm surprised something like this didn't happen a longer period of time ago. But you see, this is what's unfortunate with the primitive minds. You know, when you've got manipulation of things like nationalism, when you got the manipulation of things like religion, culture, you know, the ideology, these types of things. These things can mesmerize a people so much, all right, that it can literally make them believe that they can just go out and act as ridiculous as these countries have acted up until this point. And let me tell you, most of these countries that are going haywire and under civil unrest, they're not acting appropriately either. I mean, if you want freedoms, if you want change, you don't go out and completely obliterate the infrastructure of your country, you idiots. You don't go out and loot the businesses. You don't go out and loot people's homes in the midst of a revolution. If you want change in the government, you go out there and you go and try to take the government. You try to go into the government buildings and, you know, just try to overtake it. But no, they don't do that. You know what they're doing out there in the Middle East? They're going into people's homes. You know, they're going into people's homes out here. They're taking their riches. They're raping their women out there. They're destroying businesses, for Christ's sake. I mean, give me a break. Anyway, 646-652-4869 is the number to call. Middle East is just completely unrest. I mean, it's a dangerous situation happening in the Middle East, and I think that America going on the military offensive at Libya as we've done, I don't think that has won many brownie points in the international community, especially within the Arab community. I don't think they really care that, we went in there and helped these people. As a matter of fact, did they care, did the Arab community care when the United States went in to Kosovo in an attempt to, stop this horrific situation that was happening in Serbia with the ethnic cleansing situation? Now, that was a definite humanitarian cause. And you're talking about a brief stint in military theater for the sake of humanitarianism. That was a military exercise, and of course it was ran by General Wesley Clark. Let me tell you something right now. I mean, that was an exercise in humanitarianism, and it was implemented beautifully. Do the Arab community, the Islamic fundamentalists, the radical Islamists, do they look at that and say, Americans, they're not that bad? No, they don't. They don't care. So, in my personal opinion, I do think that America should have some sort of interest in orchestrating the events that are happening here in the Arab communities. But I believe it should be done on a clandestine level. This overt military action is just putting more fuel on the fire, I believe, to the fanaticism of those that want to be Islamic terrorists, man. Anyway. 646-652-4869. I want to hear from you, folks. I mean, give me a call right now, all right? I know there's a lot of people listening in. Give me a damn call, 646-652-4869. I mean, we're talking about Obama. He's going to talk a little bit about, why we should be in Libya tonight at 7:30 Eastern time. We're talking about how Japan has now found plutonium in the soil at Fukushima, not to mention that we're seeing radioactive material in the rain as far as Massachusetts in America. And yet the Japanese government continues to sit on its thumb and not do anything about it. I think that this is a ample opportunity for these international institutions for them to go in and basically put the damn lid on this nuclear reactor, man. You know what I'm saying? Not to mention, we talked a little bit about the destabilization in the international community, in the Middle East specifically. Yemen, there's an explosion today killing 78 people amidst anti-government protests. Syria, trying to, strive for some kind of order out there. It's going to hell in a handbasket right before Assad's very eyes. And it's beautiful. I love seeing despots and these assholes that are bequeathed power that really, have to assert their leadership. They're threatened by, domestic unrest. I love to see them in action because, I hate leaders that just kind of just sit back, do nothing. They think that just, things are going to run themselves. I mean, if you're going to be a leader, why don't you prove that you should have some kind of leadership? Let me go ahead and chug this here. Good stuff, baby. Anyway, let's talk about something else, for Christ's sake. I mean, we know that they're killing people, like in the masses out there in the Middle East. Even though we're in Libya for some reason, I don't know. Who cares? I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the answer is. In my personal opinion, I think this is healthy for the Middle East. I think this is healthy, even though it may cause a little disorder. It may jeopardize some things out there. I mean, I think that these people need to kill each other for a little bit so that they can realize, hey, I don't want disorder. I don't want chaos. I don't want, to die. I want to live under some kind of order, and I want to be able to live lavish. I want to be able to live good, and then they'll start accepting capitalism and democracy. And to be honest with you, I don't care if they even accept democracy, capitalism does not need democracy to flourish. Remember this. But capitalism inevitably leads to political freedom. It just inevitably does. You know, so I feel that, you know, this is healthy. I just think that, you know, it's sad that, you know, our president and our political apparatus here in America doesn't know what the hell to do. They're stupid. They're utterly stupid. I hate to say it, but they're moronic. Anyway, let's talk a little bit about what's going to happen in April 29th next month. Oh, yeah, I'm talking about, oh, it's the English wedding. Oh, yes. Oh, look, it's Prince William. He's going to marry that young girl. Well, she's not young, but she's 29 years old. That girl, Kate Middleton. Oh, yes, Kate Middleton. And April 29th is going to be a royal affair. Oh, yes, and you know who's going to pay for it? You know who's going to pay for it? The English people. Oh, yes, the English people are going to have to pay for the English wedding. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I mean? The English people are going to have to pay for the royal wedding. You know what else you're going to have to pay for? You're also going to have some austerity measures. Oh, yes, you got to have some austerity measures. We've got to cut your socialism. We got to cut your socialism while, you know, we pay for William's wedding, for Christ's sake. What are you talking about? You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it's what we have to do. You know, you people just gotta, you know, you can't have any meat if you haven't eaten your pudding. You know what I mean? You can't eat your meat. You give me a break. You know what I mean? So anyway, let me get serious here. April 29th, Prince William and Kate Middleton are going to get married, and I know everybody is just, they can't wait, can't they? They're just like, oh, my God, I can't wait to see the dress that Kate Middleton's going to wear. Oh, I'm going to go out and buy it, and I'm going to go to the happy hour at the Class Act Club and make sure that one of these old swinging schlong heads looks at me, and maybe he'll buy me a drink, and maybe he'll pay for my car payment. I mean, seriously, I mean, give me a freaking break, all right? Give me a freaking break with this stupid, dumbass wedding, for Christ's sake. You know, I know I've been critical to these limeys out here. I've been having a lot of English people call me up on the broadcast, and I've been clowning them for, you know, worshiping this monarch, you know, justifying this monarch, for Christ's sake. But let me tell you something, all right? The British people don't like what's going on. And let me tell you, I know there's British people that have called me up and said that, but I'm starting to believe it now. Because now British anarchists have made it publicly clear that they are going to protest wholeheartedly at the English royal wedding next month. Oh, my God. So be expecting, you know, more money coming out of the English treasury. Yeah. Be expecting more money because they have to, you know, pay more security. They're going to have to pay more cops to be on the road. They're going to have to pay this. They're going to have to pay that. Meanwhile, the British people have to go through an austerity measure, meaning that they are going to have a lot of benefits that they were used to as semi-socialist citizens cut because the British government can no longer afford these things. Meanwhile, they have the royal wedding, and I don't even know how much this is going to cost the English people, you know. But they, you know, they're bringing out like, you know, 1,700 chariots with jewels and diamonds, and they're bringing out all the garb and, you know, the royalty and all this prehistoric, dumbass, primitive concept of feudalism. And let me tell you something, you know, if the English people were smart, you know, instead of protesting and, you know, making a ruckus, because you're justifying, unfortunately, by going out and, you know, making a ruckus, you're justifying the legitimacy of the royal family, you know? But in my personal opinion, I think that everybody should just go out in England, all right, and just carry signs around themselves saying, we don't want to pay for the royal family anymore. We don't want the royal family. We don't want you, all right? You serve no purpose, all right? You serve no purpose. And, you know, why exactly should the English people, and look, I'm all for austerity measures, believe me. I have no love loss for people that are pissing and moaning about the austerity measures in socialist Europe. But in my personal opinion, I think it's rather crappy that you have English people having to go through austerity measures, having to, you know, bite the bullet. You know, they know that, hey, maybe the socialism, you know, didn't work and, you know, we can't pay for ourselves. English people aren't stupid people. They're just, you know, a little proud of their culture, which I think is a little ridiculous. But now they're starting to realize that, hey, wait a minute, why exactly are we continuing this charade with this royal family that isn't even the original blood lineage of the original royal family of England anyway? So, I mean, well, why are we continuing to pay for these schmucks? Why aren't these people taking a pay cut? You know what I'm saying? You know, why aren't these people just, you know, for a lack of a better term, you know, giving them a lump sum payment and getting the hell out of our country? All right? I mean, we don't need to go back to prehistoric monarchism. All right? We don't. All right? All this, you know, fetish of, oh, Kate Middleton and oh, William and oh. It's just disgusting, man. We don't need any more of this crap. We don't need to go back into the old world. You understand? This is a new world now. You understand where, you know, people don't want to be ruled by some stupid despotic, you know, nepotistic, feudalistic royal family or some emperor or some dictator. You know, it's about capitalism. It's about political freedoms that enable capitalism. And that's what it's about, man. I mean, capitalism provides the opportunity for everyone to exercise every appetite that they ever wanted to indulge in. Every ambition to be achieved. I mean, it gives everybody the opportunity for everything. And those in the international community are starting to recognize this. And at the same time, they're starting to recognize the contradictions. And I'm glad to see, I hope that anarchists don't, you know, cause, you know, some kind of a disgusting ruckus out there at the English royal wedding. But I think that the English people should be protesting this English royal wedding, without a doubt. Without a doubt, I think it's a disgrace that English tax dollars are still going to these people for no reason whatsoever. And I heard some limey blonde bimbo on Imus the other day, what was it, last Friday, trying to justify this stupid royal family by saying, oh, you know, well, they bring a lot of money into the English economy. That's why everybody comes to England, because they want to see, you know, Buckingham Palace. They want to see the royal family. Oh, yeah, they bring a lot of money to the, you know, to England. And I almost puked up the damn, you know, bacon and egg taco that I had that morning, for Christ's sake. You know, we got some taco places out here in Austin, Texas. And I literally almost, you know, puked it up because this bimbo is actually trying to say that the justification of these extravagant, you know, expenditures by the English people are justified because they bring in money to the English economy. It's just disgrace. Oh, Jesus Christ. It just, that's what it makes me want to do. But let me tell you something right now. If these royal family, these indulgent, gluttonous old windbags, if they don't start realizing that the pertinence of their existence is no longer needed, well, then they themselves are going to inspire, in my view, I mean, just by looking at all the things that are happening here in the United Kingdom. I mean, you know, first of all, the United Kingdom, they give, it seems to me, more rights to Arab extremists that go out in the street and blatantly say they want to, you know, blow up things, they want to blow up buildings. They give them more rights than English people do for saying, hey, we don't want to have anything to do with these stupid, dumb monarchs. We don't want to have nothing to do with them. You understand? We don't want to have nothing to do with this old world, disgusting, despicable, feudalistic idea. Do you understand that for 1,000 years, feudalistic powers reigned supreme in the world? And what happened to humanity during that time? It remained stagnant for 1,000 years. Nothing happened. Nothing progressed. It was the same thing for 1,000 freaking years when these monarchs were in power. And now what, we're supposed to praise these people because they're getting married? I spit on these royal family. You know what I'm saying? And if they continue, I'm telling you, I mean, what they need to do is take responsibility and realize that they're not wanted, really. You know, maybe they should take a back seat. Maybe they should make some PR moves and let everybody know, oh, look, we're no longer going in our 1,700 jewel-infested chariot. we're selling it on the world market so we can raise money for the poor or do something. But no, they do nothing. They're indulgent, gluttonous, disrespectful, pompous-ass people, and the English are starting to get fed up with it. And let me tell you something. These anarchists, man, this is getting serious. You know what I'm saying? I mean, didn't I hear this battle cry once before? I mean, doesn't everybody remember this back in, like, the 80s, for Christ's sake? I mean, does everybody remember?
Ridiculous, pathetic, gluttonous,
undeserving wedding in our faces makes me sick. So that song right there, Sex Pistols, you know, Anarchy in the UK, that goes out to all my capitalists out there in England, out there in the UK, that are just as disgusted as I am with this royal family, and they don't want to have anything more to do with it. As a matter of fact, for all my English brothers, capitalist brothers out there that are sick and tired of this royal family, I challenge you, please, go and join the Capitalist Army at capitalistarmy.com, all right? Simple as that. And keep us informed about what in the hell's going on out there in that feudalistic monarch country of yours, so that we can be able to, you know, have a better idea of what's going on, so we can keep ourselves afloat with the different reports that come out of countries that are attempting to press capitalist endeavors. Anyway, folks, I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Please give me a call, 646-652-4869. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. I want to hear from you. Anyway, I think I'm about done talking about this stupid, dumb, disgusting, pathetic royal wedding. Oh, yes, it's going to be Kate Middleton. Oh, yes, and William. They're going out there, they're going to marry in the middle of April 29th out there. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm serious. I'm sick of the royal family. I spit on the... I know for a fact that I can never go and travel to England again. I mean, I know if they banned Michael Savage from traveling into the UK, you know my name's on a goddamn list there. Anyway, 646-652-4869. Let's move on to something else. I don't want to talk about the royal family. They make me sick. Any kind of old world concept, any kind of primitive concept like that makes me ill. So let's talk a little bit about something else. Does everybody remember Robert Gibbs, the press secretary, or the former press secretary of the Obama administration? You know, he was that red-haired ginger that went out, you know, every morning trying to justify the incompetence of the Obama administration. He's the one that talks to all the press corps and the press junkets, and he's a little four-eyed ginger that went out there and was just a, you know, unbelievable liar, you know? He's just an unbelievable liar. Well, anyway, if you want to talk about crony capitalism, you know, and look, capitalism is not crony capitalism, all right? But consequently, who picks up Robert Gibbs for an employment spot but Facebook? Oh, Facebook got Robert Gibbs. I mean, can you get any more crony capitalism, man? I mean, you know, you got Mark Zuckerberg and all these tech idiots, you know, basically owning the Democratic Party over here. I mean, as a matter of fact, Facebook and all these stupid social networks are the cause of a lot of the social unrest that we're seeing throughout the international community currently. All right? And now you've got Robert Gibbs, you know, the professional liar himself, going to Facebook. You know, who the hell knows how much he's going to get paid, probably something in the millions, you know, how these bureaucrats are. Just like Rahm Emanuel, you know, never stepped foot in any kind of college or finance school or anything, but after, you know, he took a break from bureaucracy, he ended up finding himself a job for $8 million. I mean, give me a break, you know what I mean? I mean, this kind of stuff makes me sick. It does. It makes me sick. Well, what do you think? Facebook now has Robert Gibbs. All right? And what does that mean? Robert Gibbs is going to be able to lie for Facebook. So whenever you hear somebody like myself saying, hey, Facebook owns your likeness, Facebook owns your blogs, Facebook owns your likes, Facebook owns everything that you post on there, it's in the fine print, there you go, they own you. Not only that, they're going to sell your information. They're going to sell your personal information and your phone number to potential advertisers. You know what I'm talking about? Bottom line, no joke. So anyway, 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. Let's take some calls here. Area code 440, you there? Area code 440. Hey, what's going on, man?
Hey, it's Baba Ganoush. I'm in the chat room right now.
Hey, what's going on there, Baba Ganoush? Man, good to hear from you.
Yeah, good to be on the phone with you. I'm just calling in. Wanted to tell you that I love your show.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Yeah, and that I'm a little bit of a newer listener, and I've been tuning in like for the past I don't know 4 or 5 days in a row now, and I've been wanting to discuss. I don't want to argue with you or get you on your bad side, but I want to discuss with you the things that I don't exactly agree with you saying.
All right.
And one of the things is you talk about police a lot and how you don't like them because they're paid by the government and that's your money, that's your tax money, and that's just wrong. You don't like that.
Well, no. I don't like police. It's not the fact that they're being paid by my tax dollars. It's the fact that they are put in a level of authority that is not that of a crime protector or a protector of the people. They are indirect taxation. That's what they are. Because I have yet to hear of any, and there are some cases, I'm not saying that it doesn't happen, but very rare does it happen where police are actually fighting crime, where they're actually catching the robber, where they're actually catching the rapists. They're actually, I mean, you know, you hear about these, cases where somebody falls off the deep end, they become a mass murderer or a serial killer, and it takes years to find them. I mean, you know, let's be honest. I mean, it's a bureaucratic rat race in the police department, just like it is in every bureaucratic institution of the government. And what I disagree with the police on is that they are not there to serve and protect the people. They are not, no matter what they say, they are not. They are more there to implement taxation on the people by putting tickets on them for these trivialized, dumb, imbecilic laws that shouldn't even need to be there. But because they're there, police officers can assert their authority to where you, as a United States citizen, especially a taxpayer paying their salaries, have no rights. And at this point in time now, because in Texas, I don't know how it is in where you're at in wherever part of the country you are, in Texas now, we're starting to get this trend by district attorneys in cities in like San Antonio, Austin, that are actually taking blood from people. They're actually forcibly taking blood from people if a police officer suspects that they're under the influence of any kind of intoxicant. And this is on a hunch. This has now been, you know, I mean, it's already been challenged in state court. They can now pull you over, and if a police officer just thinks that you're under the influence of any kind of intoxicant, they can forcibly withdraw your DNA from your body. And nobody, and I mean nobody, should have that type of authority, especially some disgusting, despicable pig that could care less about the American people's safety and more about collecting more and more tickets and taxpayer dollars so that they can justify their inflated budgets. That's my argument. I'm not against, tax dollars going to police officers. I'm against how they're being paid and what they're being paid to do.
All right, well, I have not heard anything about that. I've never even heard of anything like that, but I am in a young police it's called the Explorers program in nearby, and what I've learned is that police officers, they don't always catch the guy because that's not exactly 100%. That's what they have the detectives. That's what the detectives do. Police officers are there to be on the streets to control the city and to make sure that people are following laws. They're not there to always catch the guy. If they can, then that's awesome.
Baba Ganoush, they're telling you that so that you can justify yourself this, you know, tremendous travesty that's happening to the people in America. I mean, I find it funny that, you know, we're supposed to be the freest society. We're supposed to be the society of opportunity and all this other nonsense. And yet our prison system continues to grow at a rapid rate. Now, why does our prison system continue to grow? Well, first of all, you have to look at who's putting these people in prison. I mean, you got to look at these district attorneys that are, you know, and you got to look at the police officers. You got to look at all the legal system in general. Now, in my personal opinion, if the police officers aren't there to maintain order, which to me means that all the rapists and all the drug addicts and all the losers of society that want to cause chaos should be the focal point of police radar when it comes to their training, well, then I have no problem with that. But that's not the case, Baba Ghadoosh. What the case is that these damn cops are more worried about writing tickets. They're more worried about writing citations. They're more worried about and you're talking about detectives. Let's go on that level. Detectives could care less about any other case unless it makes the news, unless it's going to give them some kind of credibility in their bureaucratic system of hierarchy. I kid you not, man. I mean, look, I understand that you're probably a young kid. You're sick and tired of the scum out here. I hope that's why you're going into police officers or entertaining the idea of law enforcement. But inevitably, it's going to corrupt you, and it's going to make you believe that you are justified in just going out and just asserting your vulgar display of power in just, you know, taxating the American people by implementing these dumb, ridiculous seatbelt laws, laws against, you know, a broken taillight, you know, these disgusting little infractions that inevitably make law enforcement, you know, have to work less on actually catching criminals and actually work more about putting innocent people into the system. Because I think that's what law enforcement is doing. It's putting more innocent people into the system. And what I mean by innocent people, people that are probably have nothing to do with the criminal system, they've never done anything wrong, they're at the wrong place at the wrong time, and because some stupid cop sees them riding down the street with a broken taillight or something's out or a damn seatbelt, lo and behold, you know, they're in a bad situation, they don't have a registration, whatever the infraction is, something that is so trivial and minute that is not taking crime off the streets. That is not taking crime off the streets. You know what taking crime off the street is? Going to these parks and, you know, making sure that these drug dealers aren't out there selling drugs to our kids. You know what solving crime is? Going out there and getting these damn burglars that are scoping out people's parking lots out here in retail locations and snagging people on their way out from going to shopping. I mean, you know, these are what the cops should be doing, but they don't. They don't. And it makes me sick to my stomach that I'm a taxpayer. I mean, I pay a lot of goddamn taxes. And these cops, every time they pull me over, they treat me like I'm the freaking enemy. What? And especially when they find out that you have nothing on your record, that you've done nothing, you have nothing on your record whatsoever. It's clean. They try to go out of their way to see if they can find something incriminating in an attempt to put you in the system. Believe me, I witness it firsthand every single day of my life. And any cop that tries to sit here and dispute that, you're a fucking liar. Excuse my French, Baba Ghadoosh, but you're a goddamn liar. Because I know for a fact that these cops are not protecting the streets. And if they were protecting the streets, we would be seeing crime going down. You know, I live 90 miles south of one of the biggest shitbags in the world. I'm talking about San Antonio, Texas. All right? San Antonio, Texas, they've got one of the biggest budgets for law enforcement. As a matter of fact, you can't even go down the street without seeing a cop on every single corner. And yet, does crime go down? Does crime go down? No. On the contrary, criminal statistics go up. And the reason criminal statistics go up is because these cops could care less about actually fighting crime. They're more worried about taxating the American people and justifying the legitimacy of their inflated budgets. And I refuse as a taxpayer to continue to watch this without saying something about it. So that's my criticism, man.
I understand what you're saying here because, I mean, that's normally what people say about police officers, how they just I understand there's a lot of like bad cops, but then there's also a lot of good cops as well.
Have you ever seen
Serpico? I think you're just being a little bit like biased. I think we've had trouble with the law. I mean, we can all see you're obviously a little bit of a drinker, so there might be some problems with that.
Hold on just a second. Hold on. First of all, I have nothing on my record. All right, nothing. I am a law-abiding citizen, and I can swear to that right now. I mean, all joking aside, Ghost, the real man, is a law-abiding citizen that has no criminal record. None. Okay? I have no criminal record. So for you to sit over here and make that assumption because I'm drinking as a reason for me not to like the law is just a ridiculous assumption, all right? All right, let me tell you something. I have no qualms. I have nothing. There's nothing on my record. All right, nothing. So for you to make that assumption, you know, right off the bat, you're coming at me from a biased perspective. And the reason you're probably coming at me from a biased perspective is because there's probably law enforcement in your family. And you see, you know what's making you come up with that preconceived notion? Is the fact that that's why I don't like cops, because right off the bat, the reason your daddy or your uncle or somebody in your family is a law enforcement, right off the bat, you're in a gang. You're in a gang, Baba Gadoosh. You know what I'm saying? And that's why you're taking so much offense to my criticisms of law enforcement, because that's what law enforcement is. It's a fucking gang. It's a gang that could care less about the American people. If they cared less, I wouldn't have to be living in a condominium here in Austin, Texas, downtown, with 24-hour security guards, like four or five of them casing the whole building. You understand? I wouldn't have to, you know, go and have a garage underneath the damn building parking lot if cops were doing their freaking job. You know, if cops were doing their freaking job, we wouldn't be hearing about, people killing their children. We wouldn't be hearing about these despicable crimes of rape and of robbery, of burglary, of murder. We wouldn't be hearing about these things because criminals would be afraid to do them. But criminals aren't afraid to do them. You want to know why? Because they know cops are hanging out at Dunkin' Donuts. Or they're hanging out on the side of the street. How many times have you seen a cop sitting in a parking lot, just sitting there chilling? Or one cop in a parking lot and the other cop is sitting next to him. You know, they're facing opposite each other, talking to each other. You understand? It's crap. And all you people that disagree with me, you people are disgusting subjects of this despicable government. All right? Let me tell you something. I want crime fought. You understand? I want my streets. I want civil order. All right? That's what I want. I want civil order. Do you think that I want what's happening in the Middle East happening here in America? Absolutely not. Do you think that I want what's going on out here in England and in Germany and all these places that are having all these protests and all this disgusting, ridiculous stuff? Do you think I want that here? No! But who's antagonizing this situation? And in my personal opinion, it's the system. And the system needs to be revamped, reformed, and it needs to be reformed fast. Okay, and to sit over here and make assumptions, oh, you're a little bit of a drinker. That just goes to show you, man, that you're a part of a gang. You're a part of the law enforcement gang. Don't you understand that that's all it is? It's just a freaking gang. Just like the bureaucrats in Washington. Just like the Congress. Just like the Senate. I mean, these people hate the fact when one branch of government asserts its authority over the other. That's all it is, man. And it's a disgrace. And, you know, I find it funny that, you know, you could sit here and justify how we're paying more and more law enforcement to be on the street. This is coming out of my tax dollars, all right? This is coming out of my money. And yet crime is not going down. Why is crime not going down? You see more and more criminals on the street. On the contrary, I mean, it's just you see more and more losers out here. I mean, it should be illegal for these degenerates to come up to me and say, come on, man, you got some change, man? You got some change, man? I mean, but, you know, you can't go but like 3 or 4 miles out here anymore without some idiot coming up to you asking you, like, You know, but our cops, you know, are they getting those assholes off of our property? Are they swooshing these riffraff out of our neighborhoods? No, they're not. So all of you people that disagree with me about law enforcement, you know what? Piss off, all right? Piss off. Once law enforcement starts fighting crime, once they start kicking the bad guy's ass, once they start acting like Pac-Man from Colors, the movie Colors, once they start acting like Sean Penn, the character Pac-Man from Colors, I don't want to hear it. I want them to start kicking ass out there. All right? I want them to start putting people in their place. But no, you know what they're doing? They're out here giving us tickets. Yeah, here's a ticket for a no seatbelt. Oh, no seatbelt here. Oh, here's a ticket for this. And I mean, it's stupid. It's pathetic. They should be kicking gang members' asses out of properties that's private. You understand? They should be putting people in jail that are robbing people and putting them in jail for long periods of time. Because let me tell you something, folks. If these cops can't protect our property, then what good are they? The basis of any capitalist system is the protection of property by the government in charge. And if the governments cannot protect our private property, well, then what the hell good are these people? If they're more worried about putting more money in the system, because this is what they're – anybody who denies that there's quotas, all right? Anybody who denies that there is quotas against any kind of, ticket quotas or anything like that, you're an idiot. You're an absolute buffoon. Now, why would there be ticket quotas? Because they want to justify their inflated budgets. And that's all there is to it, man. That's all there is to it. I mean, you know, people are saying, hey, I'm complaining that prisons are growing, and yet I want, the police to kick some ass. Well, why are the prisons growing? They're growing because of drug offenses and, idiot child support offenses. And, the most stupidest crimes you can think of, man, are being put out here. You know that violent criminals make a very low percentage of our prison system? Most of our prison system is a bunch of dumbass bureaucratic nonsense that has been put forth by our law enforcement, that has been put forth by our district attorneys, for Christ's sake. It's stupid, man. It's utterly pathetic. I mean, I'm for a police that's going to, kick the criminal's ass, all right? And let me tell you, I'm a law-abiding citizen. Once again, all you people that think that I'm pissed because I got busted or something, I've never been busted for a goddamn thing. All right? I've never been busted for a goddamn thing. But the bottom line is that I am not going to sit here and continue to watch these police, and let me tell you, it's not just to myself. They harass anybody who is not in the system. Not in the system? Oh, man, they're going to try to look at your car or try to look, where are you going? What are you doing? But if you're one of these revolving door criminals that they see on the streets and bust on a consistent basis, they're like, hey, what are you doing? Oh, just get out of here. Meh, meh, meh. Yeah, I don't know. I'm sorry. I know. That, Baba Ghadoosh over there got a little upset because I made fun of Daddy or something, and he's like, hey, you're lying. That's not my mentality. I'm a cop because I really want to be a cop. Bullshit, all right? Bullshit. Anyway, let's take some other calls here. 408, you're on the air.
What's popping, Ghost? How you doing?
Hey, man, what's up? What's going on, Goofy Bone?
Yeah, I feel your pain, Ghost, because, I'm a taxpayer, Ghost. I don't know if any of these people know what a taxpayer is, but when we work, we pay taxes. And those tax money that they take from our check goes to paying these cops. The ones that sit at the donut shop that expects free donuts. The one that wants free coffee all day while he sits and claims he's reading a report when you don't have to take all day to read a report. For real.
And not to mention, you're right. Let me tell you something. These cops expect crap for free. You know, let me tell you, I have seen many a cop, and I've been out here in Austin. You know, I like to patronize the places out here. There's a great nightlife scene out here. No matter what age you are, believe it or not, you can be an old gentleman or an older woman and go out here and have a great time. It's a great atmosphere. But I have seen it countless of times when places are actually charging cover. These cops, in plain clothes, they throw their badge on. They take it out of their damn wallet, and they throw it at the person that's supposed to be collecting the cover charge, and they just let them in there. They just let them in. Like, it's okay, go ahead. I mean, hell no, man. I mean, if that was my club, I would say, Mr. Officer, I don't care, you know, unless you got a warrant to be in here, you're going to have to pay the cover charge like everybody else. But you see, that's not how cops are, man. They just think that they have this unbelievable authority just to be able to do whatever it is they want, and that's what I'm against. I'm not against them going out there and fighting crime. I'm not out there, you know, I'm not against them going out and kicking the robber's ass, the rapist's ass, the murderer's ass. I don't care about that. What I am pissed off about is that all of a sudden American taxpayers, which are capitalists, any American taxpayer is a capitalist, we're being targeted by these disgusting, trivial laws that are just the biggest indirect taxation to mankind, since socialism, for Christ's sake. Because you have to think, you know, all a cop has to do is have a hunch now, man. They don't even have to have any kind of probable cause any longer. They just kind of pull you over and have a hunch, and they'll just create laws. Just look online, man. You know, look online. There's a bunch of cops that have been caught on video abusing their authority, abusing everything because they can do it. Because they can do it. And you see, us as the taxpayer, we have to show them that, you know, they can't do this. You know, and the way we show them is by saying, look, maybe we should be looking to alternatives for law enforcement, as opposed to sitting here with the current situation we have currently, man. I think maybe we should put a higher standard for law enforcement. Also, haven't you noticed that, you know, all you have to do is have a damn GED, and you go to the police academy, and if you can answer the written questions up to capacity and pass the physical demands, you're in there. I mean, seriously.
An 8-week program. That's what it is, Ghost. An 8-week program for these idiots to just get a badge and go out and start beating people's heads in. You know what I mean? I've been harassed by cops all my life, regardless of my Mexican heritage or whatnot. My car attracts cops. Why? Because it has tint on it. I always get pulled over for tint. But then when I fight it in court, they never show up. So it's like, are you serious? Why waste my time? So I try to waste their time. You know what I mean? And to those people out there who hate cops as well.
You shouldn't even have to do that, man. Isn't that stupid, though, man? You shouldn't even have to do that. I mean, not only are you wasting your time, they're wasting taxpayer money. They're wasting, you know, time, you know, messing with you for a tent when they should be out there fighting crime, going into neighborhoods, making sure people ain't breaking into windows, breaking on cars. They should be out there scoping parking lots, because that's what these fools like to do nowadays, man. They like to sit in parking lots in the car. They see some vulnerable old lady, or they see some chick or something with a nice purse or, you know, some nice gold on. They go up to them with a gat right off the bat. Boom, they jack these people. They should be looking after stuff like that, but they're not. They're useless, man. I'm sorry. And I know that, you know, Baba Ghanoush over there got a little sad about it. But hey, tough titty, man. This is the way the world is. This is what happens. Police are not there to serve and protect. They're there to tax collect. Bottom line.
But for real, Ghost, because I know the rules. I got locked up for BS. So what I did was taking that time. Once you're locked up, you can't do anything. So sit there and read the law books. See what things you could do against them. When they pulled me over last time, I told them that I wanted to see their desk officer, because they said I fit a profile, but this guy had no proof of anything or whatsoever. So I asked for his desk officer. And once you do that, they have to come to the scene. They have to come to the scene. So I told him, I go, this guy says I fit a profile, da 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 da. And then he gives him a certain look, and he goes, you know what? Get in your car and get out of here. So it's like right there, he got busted. He didn't think, he thought I was some stupid Mexican, didn't know anything. But right there,
unfortunately, cops really, that's a cop that's probably been busted for some garbage that, you know, that you were kind of indirectly telling him before. He's probably been busted for abusing his authority. Most cops don't care. You see, the cops that care actually want to become like sergeant and captain and, you know, all this other crap. But these lifers, you know, these life beat cop assholes, these guys that, you know, are on the beat for like 30 years, they don't care if they get written up. They don't care if they get written up to for abusing their authority. They don't care. They're still going to get their pay. They're just like teachers, man. You cannot fire a cop unless they literally rape a transsexual in the back of some police car. I'm not joking. Look, I was just talking about San Antonio, Texas. The reason I bring them up is because they are a garbage city. They're 90 minutes south of San Antonio, or of Austin, Texas, and San Antonio is just a complete and utter garbage hole. Anyway, cops down there, I mean, literally, they've been busted for moving cocaine for Mexican mafia. I mean, they've been busted for all kinds of garbage, and, you know, it's hard to bust these people. Even when they caught these guys, the feds had to come in and bust these idiots. So, what I'm saying is that we need to start realizing as taxpayers that these cops are not there to serve and protect, man. I'm all for going out there and getting the robber, getting the killer, getting the murderer, anybody who's going to reject the idea of private property and basically jeopardize the integrity of our capitalist system by going out there and rob. I believe me, I am not against law enforcement. I'm against what they're doing now. And in my personal opinion, they're throwing people in prison for the most mundane, ridiculous reasons. And I think that what we should be throwing in prison are killers, murderers, rapists, these people that deserve to be in prison, the people that are detriments to our society. And in my personal opinion, I feel that the cops at this point in time could care less about us American people. They just care about their stupid pensions. That's why they got unions. That's why even if they get busted for doing something dramatically wrong, like beating Rodney King, well, all they got to do is get their union rep, beat the case, and they're back on the street. All right, I'm not joking. I mean, this is the way the cops work. This is not your regular, everyday, oh, he did a bad thing, let's fire him kind of occupation. These people have unions, just like the teachers. And out down there in San Antonio, one of the most recent cops that got busted and, you know, fired and prosecuted was some cop that raped a transsexual in the back of some goddamn cop car and in the back of some building somewhere. I mean, you know, this is the kind of extreme that a police officer has to do to get fired. I kid you not. Look it up for yourself.
You know,
I mean, it's stupid, man.
You know what? Which cops I really hate are the ones on the bikes. Those guys dress up like they're going to war or going to, you know, like they're in Poland and taking over the town or some shit.
Oh,
like that.
Man, let me tell you something. One of my worst experiences with these damn pigs was with a bike cop. And let me tell you something. I got stopped, all right, because I had a good car at the time. I mean, I always ride around in nice cars, riding around in brand new Cadillac. And, you know, I was stopped and, just kind of smoking a cigar, looking nice. You know, I like to wear some gold, you know, that sort of thing. This bike cop just took it upon himself. I was waiting in line at a red light, all right, downtown. And this bike cop took it upon himself to just kind of, you know, pull me over and said, pull over right over here. I should have just kept going, really, and just, you know, what the hell is the bike cop going to do? But I knew that he would have probably had my license plate. That would have been more charges. You know, these idiot cops like to throw so many charges at you because, they can. So the guy forces me to pull over in some parking lot, and believe it or not, this guy pulls me out of the car. He, you know, searches my ride, you know. He said that my registration was out when, you know, he's like, I'm sorry, I must have read it wrong, after he already infringed upon my personal liberties. And inevitably, he didn't, he got nothing. You know what I mean? He didn't bust me with anything. He just wasted about an hour of my life because he had a hunch that, I guess I was an older gentleman in a Cadillac and smoking a cigar, that I was, a dealer or a drug dealer or a kingpin. I mean, this is just stupid. That's stupid. That's a true story. I kid you not. A bike cop pulls me over, does the whole rigmarole, pulls me out of the car, I'm an old white man, all right? I got a suit on. Don't get me wrong. I do have a suit, all right? But I mean, give me a break. I mean, and how is this protecting the downtown area? You know, some bike cop, you know, taking it upon himself to just kind of, you know, claim that my registration was expired. And then when he realized that I knew it wasn't expired, and after a whole search and all this questioning, where I was going, what I was doing, all of a sudden this guy's like, oh, man, well, it wasn't. It wasn't expired. I'm sorry. Go ahead and have yourself a nice day, sir. I didn't stupid, dumb fucking pig, man.
You know, I don't mean to get off subject, but I didn't know Opus cigars were $60. Opus X.
Yeah, man, what are you talking about? That's why I smoke them, man. Opus X cigars, baby.
I bought one the other day, an Opus X Double Corona.
Yeah, absolutely. Did you get the gift set or what? Did you get a double gift set or what would you get?
Oh, no, I got a single. I just got a single one.
Oh, you got the single? No, let me tell you, man, that's why I smoke Opus X cigars, man. First of all, that tobacco, that brand is just, even the secondhand smoke smells unbelievable. I just love Opus X cigars. They're great. As a matter of fact, I'm in the works right now to have a hand roller that I know out here in Austin, Texas, to hand roll my own personal signature capitalist cigar. We're going to try to emulate what's in Opus X, but Opus X raises that that tobacco that's in that cigar a little bit differently, so we're going to try to do whatever we can to try to emulate that Opus X style. But there is going to be a capitalist cigar. I'm going to be selling it on the Capitalist Army website. And as a matter of fact, I encourage everybody who, you know, hasn't applied to go to the Capitalist Army, do so. CapitalistArmy.com. You can actually sell stuff on your profile, man. I don't charge you anything. There's no, you know, 5% and 8% and 10%, nothing. Just go sell your stuff, make money, and that's what it's all about, the Capitalist Army, man. But I saw that you were thinking about just cutting it open and rolling it for a blunt. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, you know what goes? I try to smoke because my friend had one. I was at a party a couple months ago. And I smoked it, and it was very, very good, but it's just like, I want to inhale it, like, because I smoke weed a lot, so it's like, I want to inhale it, but it's like,
I can't inhale it, man.
Yeah, I know, I can't do that, so it's like, I'm going to try to roll it as a blunt, because I have a big occasion coming up.
No, man, no, don't do it, man, please, do not ruin a cigar like that, man. I mean, that is a badass cigar. Why don't you flip it or something? Man, do not cut it open and roll it as a blunt, man. That is not a Philly blunt, all right? That is not some crap that you can get down the street at some Habib store. What flavor do you want? What flavor do you want? Do you want the grape? You want grape flavor? Yeah, you can't do that, man. It's an Opus X cigar. You got to smoke the cigar. Don't inhale it, for Christ's sake, because that's not what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
You know, you're supposed to, not to mention,
you want some alcohol. That tastes so delicious, you know, to those smokers.
Get some alcohol,
you know,
though, man. Get some alcohol. And not only that, after you eat a steak, make sure you have a steak or some kind of, you know, big, you know, dead carcass of a cow, and eat the flesh of that. And after you eat the flesh of that, that's when you smoke a cigar and then, you know, sip on some cognac. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you can't get any more pimp style than that, man. You got an Opus X cigar, you got cognac in the hand. The only thing that you're missing is a Bimbo. You know what I'm saying? With some big knockers. Like a Bimbo that looks like that Bimbo on the St. Pauli girl bottle or something. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, I know. You know what, Ghost? I'm going to email you a girl that dressed like that I banged, and I'll try to get her on the show. She's one of my personal friends, but, you know, she wore the outfit. Oh, my God, she has the tits for it, too. But I got to go, Ghost, but I want to give shout-out to my friends in the chat room. Can I do that?
Go for it, man.
All right, shout-out to Billy D. Williams, Kevin Daly, Future DMB, my homeboy Goku, and Heavenly Angel, what you call it, Strout, what's up, homeboy, and everybody else out there in the chat room. Much love. And much love to you, Ghost Man. I know the market took a dump today. I don't know if
it didn't really hurt me very much at all. As a matter of fact, it was in the plus side most of the day until the last hour for some reason.
Oh, Michael Thomas, I'm sorry. Shout out to Michael Thomas, I forgot. But yeah,
no problem, man. Hey, don't puff on that magic dragon too much there, buddy.
Yeah, I know. I'm Mexican. I have to do something illegal. And look out for my album, Illegal Alien, coming out 9/10/11. And I'm going to drop 9/10/11.
It's coming out 9/10/11.
Check it out.
All right, man. Thanks a lot, Goofy Bo, man. We appreciate you calling, bro.
Much love, Ghost.
All right, man. You take it easy. That was a little bit of Goofy Bone, you know, the infamous singer of Just Give Her a Bone. Everybody knows that song, you know what I'm saying? Anyway, 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. I didn't mean to get off on this tirade about cops. We just had Baba Ganoush up in here call me up saying that he's a future cop, and he didn't appreciate me talking about cops. Then when I told him why I don't like cops, he got a little upset and left. So, I mean, I hope he's not bent out of shape. But hopefully, you know, he understands that cops are there to serve and protect, not tax collect. You know, not sit here and assert their authority like they're the overlords of our country or something of that nature. They're supposed to be protecting private property. They're supposed to be protecting people. And in my personal opinion, they're not doing that. All right? They are not doing that at all. Hey, that's a good point. Hey, Debbie Daly, what's going on? I didn't see you in the chat room. Debbie Daly said, hey, why don't you, Goofy Bone, release it at 6.07 and 8 seconds on 9/10/11. That's pretty cool. Anyway, 646-652-4869. Let's move on to another subject matter. Before we got into that cop tirade, we were talking about how Robert Gibbs, the former press secretary of the Obama administration, got himself I'm pretty sure it's a multi-million dollar gig with Facebook, and I'm sure Facebook is going to need all the PR they can. You know, remember, Robert Gibbs is a professional liar, all right? I mean, this is a guy who justified all the complacency and the hypocrisy in the Obama administration every morning to the press, and he's an expert at it. So this is exactly why Facebook has got Robert Gibbs. And why does Facebook want Robert Gibbs to lie for him? Well, because Facebook wants Robert Gibbs to kind of lightly and delicately tell the people that, hey, we own your likeness. We own your information. We own everything that you do on Facebook. We own your likes. We own everything. And we're selling it. We're selling it to the highest bidder. And I reported this, what was it, several weeks ago, that not only is Facebook trying to gather up psycho and demographic data on its users, but now it is going to sell names and addresses and phone numbers of its members to advertisers. Yeah. It's going to sell numbers and addresses to advertisers, for Christ's sake. So if you're a Facebook user, I mean, give me a break. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, I don't want to talk about Facebook. I hate Facebook. Well, let's talk about Facebook a little bit, all right? Because there is another report out today that, you know, some kind of British, or no, some kind of study. I don't know who the hell did it. I don't care. But apparently, Facebook is causing teens to become depressed. Oh, teens are getting depressed because of Facebook. Oh, I mean, is this for real, for Christ's sake? I mean, teens are actually getting depressed because of Facebook? Because, you know, I got to have Facebook. I'm so enthralled with it. And if I can't get Facebook and I can't get friends and if I can't have likes and I can't have people to talk to on the Internet, I'm going to go insane because I can't talk to anybody in real life because I'm a fat loser and I got pimples on my face and I'm a freckle-faced bastard. And I'm a teenager and I don't know what to do and I have to have Facebook. I have to have Facebook. Shut up. I mean, can you believe this crap that Facebook is actually causing teens to get depressed? I mean, you're a teenager, for Christ's sake. What are you getting depressed about? I mean, this should be the time of your life. You know what I mean? I mean, you should be going out and trying to bang, you know, teenage bimbos. It's the only time you're going to be able to do it before you become a damn subject on Chris Hansen's To Catch a Predator. You know what I'm saying? What are you talking about? You're depressed.
I'm depressed, man. I'm depressed.
I think you're an idiot. I mean, how the hell can you be a depressed teenager because of Facebook? I mean, Facebook is ridiculous. First of all, Facebook doesn't even have that many, doesn't have that many options as a social network, man. I mean, you can't even do anything on there. I hate the concept of it. I hate the, I mean, it's so lame, and it's so simplistic, and it's so stupid, man. And yet, the valuation on this stupid company is $60 billion for goddamn Facebook. $60 billion. Screw that, man. Screw that. I mean, these people are idiots. And, you know, teenagers, seriously, man, you should really, you know, if you're depressed, why don't you go drink or something? You know what I mean? Everybody else is doing it. Hey, look at MTV. You know, if you watch the show Skins, that is of, you know, teenage adolescents just kind of having sexual orgies like they're going out of style. I mean, I don't understand why teens would be depressed. I mean, you know, you look at all the stuff on TV, you know, teens are becoming teen mothers, they're having sexual orgies, they're drinking, they're doing drugs. And now they're saying that, you know, what, Facebook is causing depression, for Christ's sake? Stupid, man. It's stupid. It really is. I mean, this just goes to show you how antisocial our society is turning out to be because of all these social networks that are dedicating all this time and effort into doing what? Oh,
look, I've got 1,000 friends on my Facebook. I got 1,000 friends. They all love me, and I tell them all my stories, and I give them all my blogs, and I send them links, and everything's so great, and they love me. They love me.
I mean, this is horrible. I mean, it really is. It's just disgusting, man. I mean, whatever happened to going out to an old social event and just kind of, you know, seeing if you can, you know, get a chick that way, or if you're a woman, get a decent gentleman that way, for Christ's sake. You know what I mean? I mean, I've heard that now 1 in 5 relationships are made online, for Christ's sake. 1 in 5 relationships are made online, for Christ's sake. Are you kidding me? Also, Facebook is the number one cause of divorce, too, mind you. You know what I'm saying? Facebook has become the number one cause of divorce because why? People are going on Facebook, friending, you know, lonely people, I guess, and, you know, they're making rendezvous arrangements through Facebook, and they're going to hotels and getting banged, and, you know, their spouses are catching them in the middle of this lie, and lo and behold, you know, you got divorces out here. Never in my lifetime would I think that women were that loose that they would actually resort to going on Facebook to hooking up with some imbecile that they saw on a picture. I mean, is this what life has turned out to be in this country, where you got to go on Facebook and judge somebody on those stupid pictures? I'm sick and tired of seeing these stupid pictures on Facebook where they slant their face to one side. What the hell is up with that crap? What the hell is up with all these idiots, you know, putting their mouths to one side and looking up like some tard, you know? I mean, can somebody explain that one to me? What the hell is that? What's that supposed to do? I mean, people look like they have some kind of a neurological disorder or some kind. Why do they slant their faces? You know, they get their lips and they squinch them to the side, and they look up. I mean, you look. No matter what you do, all right. If you're a fatty, you're a fatty, all right. If you don't like the way you look in pictures, maybe you should put the fucking fork down, broad. All right, or guys are doing this too. I'm not just picking on the women here. Guys are doing this. You know, they're fruiting out with these stupid little pictures with their faces slanted to one side, for Christ's sake. All right, if you don't like the way you look in the picture, either rearrange that disgusting face you got going on there, or why don't you go and lose some damn weight, all right? I mean, if that's really concerning you, stop with these disgusting, stupid pictures with the slanted face and the slanted, I mean, there are other ways to manipulate the picture other than to slant your face and to look upwards. I mean, you know, you can put some lighting in there. You know what I mean? You put some makeup on or something. I mean, good God, man. I mean, where are the parents to tell these kids this shit? Jesus Christ. I'm serious, man. I mean, Anyway, I'm sorry. We're going off because Facebook is linked to teen depression. You know, teens are becoming depressed because of Facebook, which is just utterly pathetic. I mean, you know, good God. Come on, teens. I mean, this is the prime of your life, for Christ's sake. Go to a skating rink. You know, I mean, go to a damn bowling alley. You know, go somewhere where you know there's going to be some kind of, you know, young people in your demographic, and just go up to a young little girl and say, hey, how you doing? You look nice. And, you know, don't be a jerk about it. Don't act like the ethnic minorities at the end of the night during last call. All right? Go up to them and genuinely act like you like them. And, you know, and genuinely show some emotion and show like you're digging these chicks. And they'll appreciate it. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, you know, you're a teenager, man. You're supposed to be having the time of your life. You know, I mean, you know, this is the time where you don't have to work. All you got to do is go to school. And sometimes you don't even have to do that, I mean, if you really don't want to. But, I mean, you go to school, you can skateboard, you can bike, you can play video games. I mean, it's just unbelievable. But in my personal opinion, I think that since you've got so many, you know, teenage girls out here that are obviously, you know, I was watching Chris Hansen to Catch a Predator last night at MSNBC. And, you know, I thought to myself, man, you know, a lot of these guys are admitting that they have done this time and time again. This is just the first time they've gotten caught. So that leads me to believe that there's actually teenage girls doing this. They're going online looking for older assholes to, you know, have rendezvous with. So that leads me to believe that obviously these teenage girls are, you know, sexually active. Why are they going after old pieces of, you know, wrinkled, bald garbage when they should be banging little teenage boys within their own age brackets? And I'm not encouraging any sexual activity, believe me. I think that people need to kind of refrain from that, you know. I mean, believe me, you don't want no kids, baby. You don't want no kids. My kids, baby. Because, man, you know, once you have kids, it's over. It's over. You know, if you know, especially you teenagers out there, if anything should prevent you from stopping sexual activity, it should be the kids. Seriously, you do not want kids. And if you don't believe me, why don't you ask all these people that are pissing and moaning about, you know, all this crap that's happening in America? Why don't you take a look at all these people that are claiming to be Poe in America? You know what they're going to tell you? My kids, baby. I can't get ahead in life, baby, because I got to feed my kids, baby. You understand? I got to feed my kids. You know? I mean, seriously, man. I mean, that's all it is. I mean, in my personal opinion, I mean, you know, teenagers that are, you know, in this report that claim that they're, you know, being depressed or they're becoming depressed because of Facebook. I mean, you know, why don't you just get rid of Facebook? Huh? Just get rid of Facebook, for Christ's sake. Facebook sucks, all right? I mean, it's stupid. It's really ridiculous. I mean, I don't understand what the hard-on is about this simplistic social network, you know? Anyway, 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. We're talking about teens being depressed by Facebook, for Christ's sake. You got to be kidding me, man. I mean, this is a joke, man. This has got to be, this is, oh, Jesus Christ. Anyway, let's go on to another subject matter. Nate Dogg, that's who I'd like to talk about. Never in my life, whenever I ever see so much press about, you know, some, you know, two-bit rapper, you know, I mean, he wasn't even a rapper. He was just one of those idiots that, you know, couldn't sing, but, you know, sang just enough to, you know, come up with some kind of a hooky little line for a chorus, and he was used and abused in the rap industry for that matter. You know what I'm saying? Now, I know people may, you know, be a little upset at me that, you know, I'm being a little critical about Nate Dogg here, but, you know, who cares about Nate Dogg, really? I mean, Nate Dogg, I'm sorry, man. I know there's people like, oh, come on, Ghost, you're out of line. You know what? Fuck Nate Dogg. What do you think about that, huh? You know, you got Snoop Dogg over here. Yeah, baby, I got me a tattoo of Nate Dogg, baby. You know what I'm saying? Got me a tattooed Nate Dogg, baby, right here, baby. You know, screw Nate Dogg. You know, Nate Dogg, Snoop Dogg, the Dog Pound, the Dog, and all these idiots are a contributing factor of why we have a dumbed-down America. You understand? I mean, Nate Dogg, I wouldn't be surprised if the reason why he died suddenly was because he knew in the back of his mind that his simplistic, stupid, pathetic messages that were being amplified on these dumbass little rap albums was a lie. All this crap about Nate Dogg being a real OG, you know, same with Snoop Dogg. I'm a real Crip, baby. I'm Calvin Brodus. You know what I mean? I'm Calvin Brodus, baby. I mean, you know, these people are, they're lying. They're not real gangsters. You're studio-ass gangsters that turn the entire nation into real gangsters by suggesting these ideas. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I'm not joking. I mean, hey, look, I do not care when a rapper dies. I don't care. As a matter of fact, another rapper died. DJ Megatron got mowed down. I don't know who the hell that is, but he's on the news, too. I mean, who cares about these rappers, man? They're the ones putting forth the notion that they're OGs, that they're out there busting caps, and they claim this on their record, man. You know, they're busting caps, they're doing this, they're doing that. As a matter of fact, Nate Dogg sang one of the most disgusting songs with Snoop Dogg I've ever heard in my life. I played this, what was it, 2 or 3 years ago. But, you know, if anybody should say, fuck Nate Dogg, it should be the people that, you know, hate this song. Because let me tell you, and this is why all the black women in black America are turning into bull dykes. Because the black women, believe it or not, during this time of gangster rap movement, they actually fell in line with all this, you know, bitches and hoes and all this crap. They actually obliged that crap. Do y'all remember they obliged all that, yeah, pimping bitches and hoes, and they actually obliged all that Dog Pound suggestion, all the you know, bitches ain't shit but hoes and tricks and all this other garbage. You know, they obliged all that, and then at some point kids came. That's right, the kids came, and then these black women realized that, hey man, these brothers that think they gangsters, they ain't making no money, man. I mean, I gotta feed my kids. You know what I'm saying? I gotta feed my kids up in here. And lo and behold, this is why you're seeing less and less black women go with black men. And they're actually going with other races, Mexicans, whites, Asians, the whole nine yards, because they know that this disgusting, despicable gangster rap hip hop scene has destroyed the black community. It has destroyed the black community to a point where that's the majority of black society, is this gangster rap hip-hop culture. There's an actual belief that there is a correlation between this gangster rap hip-hop culture and black America, when there is no connection. It was a suggested connection by the people that made money off of gangster rap. And this is why I'm saying Nate Dogg, Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, all these people that made money off gangster rap, I will not cry when these idiots die off the face of the planet. You understand? I mean, seriously, you know? I could care less about Nate Dogg dying. As a matter of fact, good riddance, Nate Dogg, you piece of crap. I remember that song. Y'all remember that song, right? There was a song out there called "It Ain't No Fun If the Homies Can't Have None," all right? And Nate Dogg sang the chorus in that song. It was off the Doggy Style album, the Doggy Style. Yeah. And you know what? You know the chorus that he sang? Here, I'm going to sing it for you, right? This is what he sang. He goes, let me see. You know what? He goes, "It ain't no fun if the homies can't have none. It ain't no fun if the homies can't have none." I mean, give me a break. You know what that means? That means that if a woman wants to get with Nate Dogg and the Dog Pound, that they have to, you know, be gangbanged by the homies. You know what I'm saying? And believe it or not, black people oblige this. I mean, the black women oblige this crap. Here, I'll sing the first verse of that song, okay? He goes, "When I met you last night, baby,
when you opened up your gap, I was feeling kind of horny. I can't do it, man. That's disgusting, man. Seriously, I can't. But just by those first couple of lyrics right there, it's a disgrace. So, you know, all this crap about Nate Dogg, oh, poor Nate Dogg, yeah, screw Nate Dogg, all right? Good riddance, you piece of crap, all right? Good riddance, piece of garbage. I'm like, we're supposed to pour out a little liquor for this asshole. Screw you, Nate Dogg, all right? You died, so I lulled. How about that? You died, so I lulled, you piece of garbage. Anyway. 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. I mean, what do you think? Am I out of line here? Am I out of line for talking garbage about Nate Dogg? I mean, this guy is a contributing factor for the reason why our social landscape is so disgusting and pathetic. I mean, he Dr. Dre, all those gangster rappers are the reasons why we have ghettos in middle-class and upper-middle-class America. This is why we have white boys out here dressing like they're straight out of Compton with the sideways hats and the pants hanging off their ass and all this other crap. It's because of Nate Dogg and because of all these idiots out here, right? Yeah, you're damn right. I heard Nate Dogg died, so I lulled. Anyway, 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. Let me take a call from Goku. What's going on, Goku?
Hey, what's up, Ghost? Nothing much here. What's going on with you?
Nah, man, just chilling, man. Just, you know, sitting here talking about Nate Dogg since everybody on the damn media thinks that it's so important to amplify this idiot's death, even though he's the contributing factor on why our social landscape is so screwed up. I mean, this is an idiot that promoted, sharing your girlfriends with your homies and busting caps and drinking 4-0s and, you know, pimping hoes and all this other crap. And what, we're supposed to care that this waste of human life, is gone off the face of the planet? Good riddance, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, this guy's actions, what gangster rap did, killed more people than anyone could ever imagine. And if anybody that doesn't believe that, you're a fool. You're an utter fool if you don't believe that gangster rap had an influence in America. And you want to know why I know? Why don't you take a look at the time before the Chronic album? You know, take a look at the time before the Chronic album came out. It was a lot different time. It was Kid and Play, and hey, Kid and Play, too hype, and it was all this like really nice, innocent little movies and these little innocent little hip hop chub rock for all you hip hoppers that know what chub rock and how Kwame, you know, all these like little innocent rappers out here. Then the Chronic album came about. And before the Chronic album, we didn't see ghettos or gangsters in an abundant amount. We didn't see these idiots trying to act like, yeah, baby, yeah, yeah. We didn't see this in an abundant amount. But when these morons, the Chronic album and, you know, Doggy Style and all these other gangster rappers ensued, this is why we have a complete disruption in the social arena of American culture. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm sorry, Goku, if you're a fan of Nate Dogg, but I hate the bastard. And good riddance, and that's all there is to it.
No, honestly, I have no idea who Nate Dogg even is, so I could care less about that. So.
No, that's good, man. It's filthy, disgusting music, man. It's disgusting. It'll just corrupt your brain into believing that, hey, yeah, it ain't no fun if the homies can't have none. I mean, that's an actual song by this asshole. It ain't no fun if the homies can't have none. It ain't no fun. That's how it goes. Now, you know what he's talking about there, right? He's talking about it ain't no fun if my homies can't, you know, bang my broad. I mean, that's what it means. If they can't bang my girlfriend, it ain't no fun. And then we're wondering why we have Maury Povich on TV with all these, your baby daddy scenarios, and people are shocked when some bimbo brings in 8 dudes at the same time. They're shocked that none of them are the father. They're participating in this type of activity, man. You want to know why? Because pop culture said it was okay to do so. So that's why I'm pissed, and I'm sorry, man. I'm going off keister, but there's a lot of people in the chat room that are shocked that I'm talking about Nate Dogg, that I'm lulling at Nate Dogg's death. Well, I'm going to continue to lull. As a matter of fact, I'm going to do a barrel roll for Nate Dogg's death. Barrel roll! There you go. I just stood up. I'm going to stand. stand up on my desk and do a barrel roll. How about that? You move this crap out. Move this crap out of the way. Hold on a second, Goku. I'm going to stand on my desk. Everybody that's watching out there in Austin, Texas, you're going to get a view here. Let me go ahead and get on here. Barrel roll! There you go. That's what Nate Dogg gets. He gets a barrel roll. Anyway, sorry, man. I'm getting a little off key. Go ahead, man.
No, it's all good. But hey, man, can I talk about this Facebook and why teens are actually depressed because of Facebook?
Yeah, go for it, man. Right ahead.
It makes no absolute sense why teens are depressed. I mean, every teen in my school has, let's see, they have clothes on their back, they have a roof over their head, they have food on the plate, and they have a good education system. Well, not great, but, it's some education. But, and yet, they're depressed because of Facebook. I mean, it's just a website. It means absolutely nothing in real life if you have 1,000 Facebook friends or if you have 100 Facebook friends. I mean, it just doesn't mean anything in life. I mean, okay, you have a lot of friends on Facebook, but do you even know half of them in real life? I mean, come on. Like, I only have 100 friends, and those are actually friends that, like, I know. Like, not, like, I don't have, like, 1,000 just random people that I see in the hallways. Like, oh, I just saw that person. I'm going to add them. But it just doesn't make sense why people are depressed over Facebook. It's a freaking social networking website. I mean, you're supposed to use it to connect with your friends. Why are you depressed? It doesn't make any sense. It's so stupid.
It's unhealthy for these kids to be depressed at such a young age, man, because they ain't seen nothing until they start actually having to pay their own way. Let me tell you something right now. When you have to actually start paying for what you do, that's when it starts getting a lot harder. And you see, that's why we're having so much trouble in America today, because a lot of these kids weren't taught how to take care of themselves. And that's why you're seeing about 30, 40-year-olds still sitting at home in mommy's basement out here, because they didn't understand how to be a capitalist. They didn't understand how to take care of themselves, that sort of thing. And the reason they're depressed about Facebook is because Facebook has become the new social landscape for everybody in America. I kid you not. I mean, there are no more social – there's no more going to the – I'm going to the mall, or I'm going to the skating rink, or I'm going to the bowling alley, or I'm going to wherever, some social hangout where kids can actually interact with each other and develop some kind of personality. There's no more of that. It's just easy just to sit on your fat ass and, watch the boob tube so you don't miss your disgusting reality programming, while at the same time keeping up with your friends and your Facebooks and your tweets on your little cell phone. And this is how people are creating social landscape. This is why when you have a lot of people, Goku, calling me up trying to prank call me, this is why they suck at prank calling. This is why they're just complete lamers when it comes to prank calling, because the American personality, the youth, they're being robbed of a potential personality. They're going to have these drab-ass personalities that aren't going to swoon anybody. And as a result, personality, in my personal opinion, is 60% of the game in American capitalism. I mean, I hate to say it. Why do you think you got a network in capitalism? It's who you know to a certain extent, while at the same time being able to actually negotiate a deal in your favor with personality and actual substance. And a lot of these kids are being robbed personality because we are now devoting our whole social landscape to a digital format. And in my personal opinion, this is a lot of the reasons why I developed thecapitalistarmy.com, because if we're going to be doing social networks, and if these people are going to, be interacting at a digital scale like we have been dealing with each other, then I think that we need to at least be focused on making money, because making money is what makes people lives easier. It makes people get what they need, fulfill all desires and needs that they want, maintain sustenance. There should be no reason why you should be dedicating your whole entire life to a Facebook where it's not making anybody money, it's not, progressing your life in any regard, it's not, enhancing your intellectual capacity, nothing. So that's why I opened up thecapitalistarmy.com, man. I mean, you got to have a social networking site behind something positive, behind something directive, if you will. And this is why I think that Facebook in the end will fail because of all this, because nobody, and I mean nobody, is going to continue to believe that this kind of social networking and what so what this kind of Facebook social networking is people in the masses friending each other based on looks and based on, you know, what kind of a picture they got or, you know, or what kind of person they are. No. What we should be all doing is we should all be coming together. And you're either with the capitalist or you're not. Because everybody else that's not a capitalist, Goku, they're the ones that are going to be the subjects whenever something dramatic happens in America, something on the ramifications of Japan. If something like that happened here in America, these individuals that are not capitalists, I guarantee you, you just mark my words, all right? If you're not a capitalist, you are going to be at the whim of this government. And as you can see with the Japanese government, they are allowing these people to be exposed to radioactive plutonium, and they are not, you know, telling these people they need to get out. They're not doing any kind of measures to try to protect the people's well-being. They're lying to the people, and they're at the whim of this government because they don't have capital to be able to get out of there. And this is why I'm telling you, Goku, and I'm telling everybody out there, if you think that I'm just a big joke when it comes to capitalism, man, you're going to be the one out there on the bus like those Katrina victims were, being bussed out to FEMA camps, while capitalists are out here, you know, being able to regroup and have the capital to continue and to continue to prosper. But I'm not saying that because I want it to happen. I'm saying that because it's going to happen. Anyway, go ahead,
yeah.
Goku. Sorry, I didn't mean to go off on a tirade.
Yeah, right, Goku. Hey, one last thing about the Japan radiation. I saw my local news that somewhere, I don't know where, I think in Cleveland or somewhere, I don't know, somewhere here in Ohio, northeast Ohio, that they detected that there was some nuclear stuff or acid detected in the rain, but it's not enough. To be any concern over, but I'm still going to keep my eye on that because that's close. That is like.
Don't believe the hype, Goku. That's what they told those poor people in Japan. That, oh, don't worry about it. Everything's okay. We got everything under control now. And now look at these people. All those people, in my opinion, this is my view. There's no report about this, but in my opinion, I believe that all those people in Japan have been exposed to massive amounts of radiation. And I think that we're going to start seeing the repercussions of that soon enough. I kid you not.
Yeah, I agree with you, Ghost. I agree with you. Hey, man, I'm going to get going. Let's take some more callers here.
All right, man. Thanks a lot, Goku, man. I appreciate you calling up, and be cool, and, you know, keep your grades up and keep capitalizing.
Yeah, no problem. See you later.
All right, man. Take it easy. All right, man. That was Goku. What's going on? 646-652-4869 is the number to call here. We got about 13 minutes left in the broadcast. What else we got on the subject matter? We were talking about Nate Dogg and about how everybody's like, oh, Nate Dogg's dead. Oh, I close my eyes only for a moment and the moment's gone. Nate Dogg, I close my eyes. Dust in the wind. Oh, here is dust in the wind. Nate Dogg. Shut up. You died, so I lulled. Anyway, let me move on to another subject matter. A report out by some British, you know, imbecilic bureaucratic scientist have done a study and have basically come up with the synopsis that even in amidst supposed equal society where women are, you know, talking about equality, women want, you know, equal rights, they want to do everything men can do, so on and so forth. This British report came out today that women still believe men should pay for dates. Yeah. And how can you get this a little bit more equal when it comes to, like, going Dutch? Like, let's say you're a man and you want, you know, you don't want to, you don't want to have to pay for some bimbo and take it around. What do you have to do? Well, according to this study, the more attractive you are, the less likely you're going to have to pay for anything. Oh, thanks a lot, Lineys. Oh, yeah. Like we needed some scientists to tell us that. Like, we needed some scientist to tell us that, you know, you got to be physically attractive to not pay for anything. I mean, do you understand? I bet you money that that was a English tax-funded government scientific study. And I bet you, you know, these scientists got paid for like 2 or 3 years to study about the obvious. And lo and behold, this is what we have here. This is it. But in my personal opinion, I think that you know, if you're going to go on a date, you should go half and half, or you should wait to see how the date goes, you know? I mean, initially, you know, y'all should just kind of, you know, pay half and half, but then you know, go from the restaurant to the bar, and, you know, you sense the chemistry, everything's going good. Well, maybe one can make the initiative on paying for most of the drinks, or the other one will. Either way, I don't believe in this crap that the men should always pay for everything anymore. I just don't believe it. And the only time that men should pay for anything is if they're actually paying for the woman that they're paying for. And what do I mean by that? I'm talking about if you're one of these old windbags that are so insistent that you have to have some 19, 20-year-old piece of poontang, and here you are, you're 55 years old, you'll never be able to keep up with the libido of this horny bitch, you know, but you insist. You insist on, you know, your 50-year-old prostate-infected ass on having a 19 or 20-year-old bimbo, then, you know, you're going to have to pay for that. And how are you going to have to pay for that? Well, you're going to have to pay for the rent. You're going to have to pay for the car payment. You're going to have to pay for the shopping. You're going to have to pay for all that stuff. You know, that's the only reason why you should be paying. I mean, if you actually want a decent woman, all right, if you actually want a decent woman, you should, you know, actually discuss these things about equality. If you want a woman that's a capitalist, let me tell you something. I'm not saying women should bow down to some man either just because he's a man, all right? I mean, there's a lot of women that are capitalists out there that are more than happy and more than willing to pay for their own meal, all right? I mean, and not every woman is out here, you know, begging, you know, assholes for free drinks or begging assholes for this and that. The problem is that those women get overlooked because they are not dressed in such a, you know, provocative manner so that they can get free drinks free. I mean, it's a disgrace, man. What I'm saying is that this report tells us, like we didn't know, that if you're some bimbo with a nice rack and a big booty, or if you're some guy that looks good in a leather jacket and slick back hair, you're probably going to have the opposite sex paying for your dinner, paying for your drinks, paying for everything. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, we need a scientific study for this horse shit. Anyway, I also want to talk a little bit about, we ran out of time here. It's 8 minutes left in the broadcast. I want to talk a little bit about, maybe the next program, about are we living in hell? You know, there's a book that came out recently, basically discussing that. You know, one of these, Jesus Christ, I forgot, you know, the, yeah, here it is right here. What the hell is this guy's name? Some book called Love Wins by Rob Bell. Rob Bell is questioning whether or not we are actually going to witness some kind of, you know, pearly white gates and Jesus and all this other crap when we die, or the sinner is going to go to hell, and all this question about heaven or hell. He actually poses the notion, and I've been saying this for years, folks. I've been saying that, you look back in the archive, that this is hell. You know, that this is hell that we're living in here. And if you don't believe me, if you still want to believe that, oh, it's Jesus and God and just the Jesus sinner, if you still want to be able to believe in that, well, why don't you answer this question for me, all right? What kind of a holy, pearly white gate, you know, holier than thou, you know, God would put us in a realm of reality where every living organism has to kill something else and consume it to survive? I mean, you know, I always ask this to all these supposed theologians, and you know what they say? Oh, it's a test. It's a test, Ghost. It's a test. A test from what? All right? A test from what? And I'm glad that this guy, what's his name, Rob Bell, He just recently released his book called Love Wins. He approaches this notion on whether or not we are actually living in hell. And to be honest with you, I've always thought throughout my whole entire life that we were living in hell. I mean, anybody that's going to try to debate me on this, I mean, please. I mean, how in the hell can we live in a reality where, the only way one can actually survive is to kill something else and consume it to live? I know that we don't have much time to talk about this, but seriously, folks, I mean, this is a serious notion that could be talked about. And, of course, all these Christians and Anglicans and Muslims and all these other, religions are all calling this idiot a blasphemous devil worshiping whatever. But, I mean, let's be honest. I mean, you know, are we living in hell? And on the contrary, have capitalists made heaven out of hell? I honestly believe they have. Are you kidding me? I mean, you know, before this time, before the internet, before you can go into your dirty, crustated drawers to McDonald's and get a triple cheeseburger, before you can go to the supermarket, before you can rent apartments, before you can rent homes, before you can do all these wonderful little easy things to do that make life so easy for everybody, people actually had to go out and do this for themselves. They actually had to build their own houses. They had to hunt their own food. They had to maintain their own survival. There was no civilization. Do you understand what I'm saying? So give me a break. I mean, this is hell. We're living hell. We're captives in hell. And that's why I always encourage everybody to be a capitalist. You know, haven't you noticed that it's always the ones that are praying so hard, oh, please, Jesus, they're always afflicted with the most pain, and the most misery, and the most devastation. And then when they go to the priest or the reverend or whoever, whatever stupid, dumb denomination they're, whenever they go in, they're like, why? Why is God doing this to me? Oh, it's a test, boy. It's a test. You know, it's a test, huh? Great. It's a test. So if it's a test, then why oblige any rules, for Christ's sake? You know, why oblige any kind of rules if we're going to be screwed in the anal passage with no Vaseline anyway? So to sit here and give me this garbage, and let me tell you something else. If all these Christians and all these people that are supposed to be holier than thou, which abuse their children, which are hypocrites to their families, which hate their spouses, which abuse their children, which have sold their children down to a path of misery, if these individuals are going to be in heaven, then I'd rather be in hell. These hypocritical pieces of garbage that sit here and try to wave their holy finger in our faces, when all they are is hypocrisy. So let me tell you something. There is no hell after this. And if there is a hell after this, I don't care. You know what I'm saying? Are you kidding me? We didn't come here programmed with any instructions. You understand that? We didn't come pre-programmed on like the spider who's pre-programmed to know that it has no friends, that it lives alone, that it has a pre-programmed architecture circuit in its brain to build its own webs. You know that engineers can't even replicate a spider web because it's such an engineerical genius a phenomena from nature. I mean, like the ant knows how to be an ant and build an ant pile. And I mean, we don't come with that kind of genetically preset program. You understand? So what I'm saying to you is, folks, and we're going to talk about this more tomorrow, and we're going to talk about this other days too, but for all you people that are, you know, throwing your hands up and wishing Jesus or somebody's going to come into your heart, you're going to just have nothing but heartache, suffering, despair, resentment, guilt. That's all you're going to be suffering with, for Christ's sake. So why bother? why not understand that there's no time for tears? There's no time for fear. There's no time for any of these ridiculous, outlandish ideas. There's only time to make sure that your life is worth living. And how do you make sure that your life is worth living? To make sure that you're a capitalist and every appetite, every desire, everything that you've ever wanted to do in your life is fulfilled. That's what continues human continuity. That's what inspires human progress. And that's why I am going to be a capitalist until I die. And I don't care if aliens come down from the sky. I don't care if a celestial event happens in this world. Capitalism will be the way of the land. Capitalism will necessarily be the way of the universe if there's any kind of alien life that tries to interfere into our system. Because we've inspired the greatest of man. We've progressed the farthest under capitalism. Without capitalism, we wouldn't know about these scientific discoveries that we've known about. Without capitalism, we wouldn't have shot ourselves into rockets into space. Without capitalism, we wouldn't have been able to prolong the human life. We wouldn't have been able to build houses. We wouldn't have been able to do the things that we've accomplished. Because we're mankind, damn it. We're mankind, and we dominate this world. We're dominate this world, and the only way that we're going to continue our continuity is if we understand that we need to get rid of these old dogmas. We need to get rid of these old philosophies. We need to get rid of these old primitive ways of thinking and understand that we're in the new age, the new world, and that world's going to be capitalism. CapitalistArmy.com. CapitalistArmy.com. Join the army. I want you. I want you. Anyway, folks, I'm sorry. I gone a little bit over time here, and I want to thank everybody for tuning in with me. But anyway, I want to thank everybody. My heart hurts right now, but I don't care. I want everybody to realize that it's capitalism. Do you understand what I'm saying? And we need to take this to the forefront. We need to make it international. And if we don't, we're going to just crumble and start all over again, just like we've done time and time again. Anyway, folks, I'm out of here. I'm going to be here tomorrow, 4 to 7 p.m. Central Standard Time, Monday through Friday. Don't forget to join the Capitalist Army, capitalistarmy.com. I'm out of here. Spread it around like wildfire, folks. We need us capitalists to get together on a global scale. We need to organize. We need to spread ideas. And we need to act in concert if necessary. Anyway, I'm out of here. Long live the capitalist movement. I'm out of here.
You've been listening to True Capitalist Radio. The thoughts, views, ideas, comments, and opinions of the host of this show are absolutely his. Catch more live episodes Monday through Friday from 3:30 to 6:30 Central, or check out archive shows at blogtalkradio.com. True Capitalist Radio.
That's it.
Boar's Head is bringing a slice of Japan to the deli. Introducing Boar's Head Ichiban Teriyaki Style Chicken. Tender, slow-roasted chicken breast, coated in our signature teriyaki glaze, where ginger, garlic, and a hint of brown sugar meet for a flavor that's both sweet and savory. New Boar's Head Ichiban Teriyaki Style Chicken. The bold flavor of Japan. Now at the deli. Only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.